It's 2:15. I think we should start. No.
Yeah. We can start. Rahul is joining. It's just message. So, is Anjana ma'am here?
Ma'am, she requested that we carry on without her. So something had come up.
Okay. Okay. So let's start.
Yes, ma'am.
Rahul is here.
Sorry.
Yes, no problem. Yes, Joanne, you can start.
All right. So welcome back, one and all. We'd like to resume the sessions for the day with renewed energy and an open mind. With that, we would now like to move on to our fifth session, which is housing. So here we look at another research done for the benefit of the economically vulnerable and how their living situation can be made more resilient in the changing times. To understand more about the resilience of urban housing communities and their shortcomings, here comes the next group with their topic, Resilient Housing in the 21st Century. Over to you.
Thanks for the introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Sheen, and along with me, I have my co-authors, Harsha, Prajwal, Anurag, Ishan, Jigmit, and Surbhi, to talk about resilient housing in the 21st century. There has been a good deal of discussion over the most resilient model for development of housing in India. Experts discuss the advantages of low-rise versus high-rise development. Rampant high-rise development is justified by giving reasons like shortage and high cost of land. Through our study, we set out to articulate the resilience of urban housing communities in an inclusive way and consider if the low-rise high-density typology can provide housing that is resilient to today's urban issues. As the 21st century unfolds, the percentage of the world's population living in cities will grow exponentially. This will lead to the cities facing challenges from pressures such as rapid urbanization, climate change, terrorism, pandemics, and increased risk from natural hazards. In this day and age, global challenges are more unpredictable due to the complexity of urban systems and the uncertainty associated with climate change. Resilience describes the capacity of a community to function so that the people living in it can survive and thrive no matter what stresses or shocks they encounter. It depends not only on the physical assets, but also on the less tangible aspects associated with human behavior, like the social and economic disruption that resulted from the recent pandemic. As tragic as COVID-19 was, causing numerous deaths, climate change could be worse. If we learn from the ramifications of the COVID pandemic, we can approach the next big crisis being prepared to mitigate its effects and prevent the worst possible outcome. We have focused our study on the two housing typologies, high-rise high-density and low-rise high-density. These two were chosen because the contrasting low-rise and high-rise typologies provide insights into two ends of the spectrum. Low-density development was not considered as the large footprint requires more land and makes it an unviable option for cities of the future. High density for the purpose of our research is a density equal to or more than 100 families per hectare. And for the purpose of our research, low rise corresponds to less than or equal to G+4 stories, while high rise is more than G+8 stories. Jigmit will take over from here.
The objective of this research is twofold: to identify qualities that enable one community to withstand, respond, and adapt more readily to shocks and stresses better than the other, and to present a comparison of the resilience of two urban housing typologies, low-rise high-density and high-rise high-density. Limitations. The parameters used to compare the performance are based on indicators that general research tells us are eminent when a community faces a catastrophe. However, we recognize that the relative importance of each indicator will be unique for different locations. So we have limited the scope to parameters that can be generalized. Our research aims to answer two questions. What makes a housing development resilient, not just livable now or sustainable for the long term? Can low-rise high-density housing provide a more resilient alternative to the rampant high-rise high-density typology? Various approaches have been taken before us to assess resilience. They focus either on urban assets or social systems. Ours is a more holistic approach that considers parameters from both these dimensions. In order to get a grip on resilience, one must be able to relate it to other properties that one has some means of ascertaining through observation. Evidence throughout the literature suggests that urban systems that have particular characteristics are more likely to be resilient. These characteristics are indicators of resilience. We summarized them to develop a framework. Our study suggests that the resilience of a housing development relates to two key dimensions, one being social, economic, and personal well-being, and the other, infrastructure and environment. Within this circle are the indicators that help identify the critical factors that contribute to the resilience of urban housing. The first dimension, social, economic, and personal well-being, considers how social and economic systems enable urban populations to live peacefully and act collectively. Included within this are the less tangible aspects. The second dimension relates to place, the quality of infrastructure and ecosystems that protect and connect society. Under this, the robustness of infrastructure that protects the population from natural hazards and climate change is considered. We then used this framework to assess the performance of the two housing typologies by diagnosing their strengths and weaknesses. Harsha will be starting with the indicators of the first dimension.
Affordability. Housing that is affordable for all can enhance cities' resilience to stress such as overcrowding from illegal squatting. In India, building height drastically affects the cost of construction. High-rise trigger higher land values that only the middle and upper classes can afford, forcing half the society onto the pavements. On an average, high-rise costs 17.5% more than low-rise in terms of construction cost in India. High-rise also have higher maintenance costs as compared to low-rise. Evaluated over their life cycle, the maintenance and operation cost of high-rise buildings is 10 times the cost in low-rise buildings. Access to open-to-sky spaces. It is a misunderstanding that in India, we make high-rise buildings without private open spaces for people because we do not have space for that in cities. High-rise developments result in only a marginal increase in open area per person after four stories. Local community support. Research is unanimous in finding that rates of helping others are lower in high-rise buildings. The social nature of most high-rise support the anonymity of neighbors. Mental and psychological health. Studies on this topic have shown contrasting results. Some found that living on the ground floor was associated with concerns over privacy, safety, and lack of control. In contrast, other studies reported residents of higher floor levels to have poorer mental health compared to residents of lower floors. We failed to find an association between floor level and symptoms of mental health problems. This suggests that it is different for every location and relates to other factors. Physical health and fitness. High-rise living is seen to radically decrease one's chance of surviving a cardiac arrest. A study concluded that the survival chance is 0.9% above 16th floor and that there were no survivors above the 25th floor. Lower response times are likely a blame for this. In addition, recent studies suggest that during the outbreak of highly infectious diseases, high-rise dwellers on all floors are at higher risk than people living in single or detached homes. Even if high-rise dwellers are isolated in their own homes, viruses can travel vertically due to the faulty ventilation systems, air leakage, and faulty plumbing stacks. Now, Prajwal will take over from here.
local business development. In case of high-rise buildings, the activity is restricted to the very few engineers and architects who can design the structures, and to the even fewer construction companies who can build them, and much of the profit goes to the bank which write the deals. Comparing this to low-rise high-density development, where employment opportunities spread through the bazaar structure among masons, carpenters, small contractors, and so on, thus the investment benefits a much wider segment of population. Crime prevention. High-rise buildings are known for higher crime rates, including drugs, theft, and burglary. It's due to a few reasons. Management can't afford enough security. Strangers can roam around easily. There is a lower visibility as compared to low-rise buildings, and there are more hiding places. The increased anonymity that naturally accompanies the large number of people in tall buildings is a key ingredient of the problem. Low-rises have better natural surveillance that comes as an added benefit with the familiarity of a people with neighbors. Moving on to the second dimension on infrastructure and environment, starting with embodied carbon. Given the same walling material, the taller buildings are, the greater will be the CO2 emissions. Due to higher steel and cement content, as we go from G+4 to G+8 buildings, CO2 emission will increase by around 35% as shown in the graph. Further, a study done on 30-story high buildings in India showed that 100% of carbon emissions can be sequestered by planting trees in available open areas in low-rise developments compared with the 57% in high-rise development. Now, Ishan will take over from here.
Operational energy and cooling requirements. In India, operational energy in residential building is mostly associated with the running of cooling equipments. In the first graph, energy used to cool the building is interrupted through the number of uncomfortable hours in the absence of cooling equipment. As we can see, a low-rise building has less uncomfortable hours as compared to a high-rise building. Operational energy also includes common service energies for the lifts and the pumps, which is 4 to 5 times more in high-rise than a low-rise. Sufficient housing for all. Contrary to the popular belief, doubling building heights does not save drastically on an overall area of the city. For Indian urban conditions, it was found that the ground floor can accommodate about 125 families per hectare, each on a plot of 44 square meters in area. 5-story apartments double this figure to 250 families. 20-story buildings double it again to 500 families. Thus, as the building height increases 20-fold, gross neighborhood density increases only about 4-fold. In exchange for only a marginal increase in the city holding capacity, high rises drastically reduce the private open to sky space available, and in our climate, the usability of housing. Renewable energy generation potential. A rooftop area to built-up area ratio of 1:3 gives the best solar energy potential. This is achieved easily in a low-rise buildings. High-rise buildings have a ratio higher than 1:7. The graph shows that 80% of the electricity demand in a low-rise building can be easily met by rooftop solar energy, compared to 31% in case of a high-rise building. Protective infrastructure. The risk of earthquake damage or serious fire hazards are much lower in a low-rise buildings, hence they have more relaxed laws as compared to more strict building codes for the high-rise buildings. Immunity to physical damage due to disasters is already an important part of building codes that apply to both the typologies. Hence, they are equally immune in this category. Now, Anurag will take over from here.
We conducted a public survey to take a deeper look into the indicators of resilience. We have taken first-hand account from both people residing in housing communities of the two contrasting typologies to compare their experiences. Due to public health concerns, our method of outreach was limited to online survey forms, and we received responses from residents of the two housing typologies all over India. Survey results have also been segregated into the two dimensions for better understanding. Starting with the first dimension relating to health and well-being, spread of pandemic. COVID infection in high-risk communities appears to have a severe effect on 29% families owing to the enclosed shared circulation pools, whereas low-risk communities have comparatively lesser spread, with 18% of families being severely affected due to more shared spaces being open. The pattern of infection within the families showed that 41% of families in the low-rise had less than 25% home members infected, while in high-rises, 18% of families had less than 25% home members infected. Community engagement and support. 69% of families living in low-rise communities interact with their neighbors on a regular basis, compared to 61% of such families in high-rise communities, which explains why families in both typologies claim to have reliable neighbors, with 65% families in low-rise and 59% in high-rise communities receiving support from neighbors while being infected with COVID-19. Open spaces. Availability of open spaces like balconies and parks for engaging in any type of physical activity became more important for physical and mental health during lockdown. According to the survey, 82% families in low-rise and 71% in high-rise communities claim to have access to open and green spaces. However, it is noticed that in case of low-rises, these spaces were mostly private spaces and not community spaces, as only 26% of the families use the community spaces owing to lack of cleaning and maintenance. On the other hand, in high-rises that have well-maintained community spaces, they are used by 70% of the families. Now, Surbhi will take over from here.
Moving on to the next dimension, which helped us evaluate the quality of infrastructure and environmental impact. Natural ventilation. Although there is not much difference in the performance of the two typologies in this category, high-rises seem to be doing slightly better, with 38% of residents relying on natural ventilation for more than 6 hours a day and only 9% of homes for less than 2 hours. 28% of low-rise residents rely on natural ventilation for more than 6 hours a day and 19% for less than 2 hours a day. This indicates that both typologies have a good scope of natural ventilation if spaces are well designed. Air conditioning. Need of air conditioning being directly related to the amount of natural ventilation, we see that 38% of homes in low-rise communities and 33% of homes in high-rise communities do not require air conditioning at all. 27% of homes in low-rise and 14% homes in high-rises require air conditioning for more than 6 hours a day. Natural light. Buildings in low-rise, high-density communities lead to 66% families in low-rises depend on natural lighting for more than 6 hours a day. High-rise buildings that get a lot of direct sunlight accompanied by glare account to 62% families in these communities depending on natural lighting for more than 6 hours a day. Conclusion. Moving on to conclusion, our study suggests that low-rise high density is the more resilient model for the development of urban housing in India. It enables urban populations to survive and thrive better in the face of diverse stresses and shocks. High-rise high density development is neither beneficial in terms of social and economic well-being, nor increases climate change resilience. We hope that our findings help assess urban India's trajectory towards a more resilient future. Thank you.
Thank you, team, for that presentation. I would now like to invite the jury to share their comments and feedbacks, and for the audience to post any questions they have into the chat box.
Rahul, you want to go first? Or?
Sudipta, you carry on. You please, you go first.
Okay. Just a question regarding the framework for assessment, that wheel diagram. If you could bring that up again, please. Very interesting.
Yes, sir. Just a minute.
Yeah, so could you tell us a little bit more about how you arrived at this?
Right. So we did a literature review of various documents that studied resilience, some about the housing communities and some in general about city resilience. We mostly, our biggest source was the City Resilience Index developed by ARUP, where they had taken a similar approach of considering all the different dimensions. So they had four different dimensions with respect to cities, and we tried to study which of those dimensions can be solved specifically by housing communities. So then we took those two broader dimensions, and then we did more study of housing communities in specific, and identified these smaller indicators within each dimension.
Right. So, the topic itself is very relevant, and it's made more relevant. It's made more relevant, of course, because after the pandemic, you want to look at everything afresh, right? So the question, the problem that I have is that we have a problem of A is equal to B, B is equal to C, and you have not proved B is equal to C, and therefore A is equal to C is becoming difficult to prove. So what you're saying is that this diagram, the circle, the wheel, is equal to resilience. And if you have measured everything against this, then therefore it proves that low-rise housing is more resilient. So the first aspect of proving B is equal to C is missing from this particular study. You understand what I'm trying to say? That defining resilience in terms of, let's say, reliable building services, or saying that sufficient housing for all, these have to be first established, that this is the meaning of resilience. Because of what resilience you showed as the ability to bounce back from stress, the ability to kind of recover from stress and strain. And so when you're looking at a concept like resilience with fresh eyes, then you also want to question it with the context of the present stresses, namely those of the pandemic, namely those of climate change. We just discussed in the previous session rising sea levels, for example, loss of employment, loss of coastal land. It could be an inequity leading to crime, looting happening because your neighbors are too poor and you are too rich, and so on. So these are issues that are now facing us, and we want to prove low-rise housing as a resilient type against such stresses. The examples that you are using, they are classic examples, the arguments of low-rise versus high-rise, arguments from Korea and Ashok Lal. These are classic arguments that are being used again and again. So I am going to be a little bit, I'm going to say that, okay, that those arguments we know of low-rise versus high-rise. I want to prove low-rise against certain new parameters, And so I want to look at the concept of resilience afresh a little bit, and then say that this in fact is a resilient type, the low rise. I'm not saying that eventually it's not going to be resilient. Most probably it will be, but it's just there's a little bit of a rational there's a little gap in my understanding or my kind of trying to figure out the arguments because of the reasons that I mentioned above. I guess I guess otherwise, if one oversees this particular aspect, then what you have done is fairly commendable. You have looked at, you've created a parameter, and I'm sure that you know the parameter, the forming of this this wheel diagram of an evaluation criteria. It's a good method for sure for analyzing something. It's a great method. You first create this this framework, and then you prove something against that framework. But creation of the framework is key to my mind. You know, you have invested so much of effort and time in proving it, but creating that framework, I want to see more effort in doing this. Mm-hmm. Your sample size for your surveys are a little bit low. They are 17 people and so on. So I would say that it would have been nicer to, I think the conclusions that you're able to draw with this sample size, this small, may be a little bit misleading. So I would say that if you have some time, extend that sample size, increase it a little bit, and try to draw new inferences from the survey results if possible.
Yeah, so about the sample size, what we had done was we had circulated two different survey forms, each corresponding to one of these one of these dimensions. And in each survey, we got around 100 respondents. But then the problem was that 75% of those respondents were from high rise, versus around only 20-25% from low rise. So difference, the vast difference in sample size was kind of skewing the results. So we discussed this with our guide, and our guide recommended that we should, if we have only, let's say, 21 respondents from low rise, then we should only consider the first 21 responses from high rise. Because due to limitation of time, we could not conduct a survey again, but now we would surely do it.
Okay, thank you.
What Sudipto said, that you've organized a framework, which is great. And my question is, you should apply this framework to housing environments rather than starting off with the assumption that there is a certain bias towards a low rise, as you understand it. Because the understanding of low rise and high rise itself is always changing. So with the changing laws today, what was understood as low-rise development itself might have certain components of high-rise, which you have already damned in your, you have said that those are the issues why we should not build a high-rise. But the point is, there can't be a fine line like this, because as the city grows, we are growing vertically. And what was typically as a low-rise development of Delhi is now a development which is imperative to have parking and elevators and apartment style, which is inching towards a high-rise typology, in the sense when you're saying it's no longer connected to the street, it's no longer connected by a staircase alone. So there are certain aspects of reasons why you are voting for low-rise are slowly and definitely kind of making space within our understanding of low-rise when we get to design it, and when the way our cities get formed. So there is something else which will give you this success rate, which is not only high-rise, low-rise definition. It is an overall environmental analysis of housing or of a community, which is, the parameter is much, has to be, so don't make that bias right away. It could be a mix, it could be a hybrid. I mean, you will see, my suggestion is, rather than seeing it from far away, if you were to see a particular case of today's housing and what the earlier models that Sudipto mentioned were done by Korea and other architects much earlier on. Since then, population has increased, the newer developments have a different challenges to be met. Whether it's parking, whether it's and we do find, I would not want to believe that if I live on the 17th floor, I would not get medical help. So in the sense, there would be ways of organizing all of that, and I'm sure there are. So that is my suggestion, that, you know, you've got a framework, but don't start off by saying that that you've already proven it. See a successful environment of a housing, and a low rise could be highly unsuccessful for the same reasons.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with this. You know, I think the entire bifurcation of low and high rise in your minds as architects is reductive. It's going to limit you as creative thinkers. So imagine, for example, something which has got a very low footprint on the ground, allowing a lot of green trees, gardens, landscapes, and then this kind of increases, you know, it increases rather than decreases in density as one goes up. If this as a type is possible, then some of your assumptions could be already wrong, right? The idea that, you know, that density reduces as you go up. So therefore it becomes more expensive. So, you know, there are types, and within types, a typological understanding of low rise as low rise and high rise as high rise as definite, crisp, solid kind of boundaries is something that, you know, as designers, we want to challenge these types. We want to kind of go beyond them and say that, you know, what's a hybrid, or what's something that we can, you know, imagine an egg crate housing where the bottom egg crate is green and the top egg crate is building, which has got enough filters. So you've got a forest on the ground, but you are living on top of tree houses. So is that a low rise or a high rise? I don't know. I mean, what I'm trying to say is that, as Rahul was saying, that there are ways in which creative thinkers can make or break types, right? So, and I would rather that you remain creative thinkers rather than scientific analysts wearing lab coats.
Yeah. I think, you know, what thing is, analysis is great, but why don't you analyze something that is successful to see why it is successful, and analyze something specific which is unsuccessful and see why it is unsuccessful. Then it might give you the indicators of what is it that we should, I mean, we do in things intuitively as architect, but what is, if you go deeper into the analysis, what is the science behind it? What drives us to do it again? That's the thing. If there are certain housings which have succeeded, then why should repeat those? Then that is what the analysis should bring about.
One way of doing that is to
Please continue. Please continue.
Just one last thing. Just to continue Rahul's point, the title is very meaningful to me always. So you've got resilient housing in 21st century, considering the environmental and social ideas embedded in low-rise, high-density housing that improve its resilience. So I'm always bombarding titles with the question, okay, where are we talking about? When are we talking about? When you've already mentioned it's 21st century, but exactly when in 21st century you've not mentioned. But where is this housing? So for example, if you said that this was in the foothills of Himalayas, or in the Gangetic, Indo-Gangetic plains, then the understanding of low rise and high rise, and one kind of analysis of resilient. If you're saying that this is in the coastal belt of the Western Ghats, or the coastal belt or the Western Ghats, then there is another kind of analysis of resilience, right? So making it particular to a region or to a very narrow kind of an idea, it helps you to focus your questions that you're asking of the type or the model a little bit more pointed. So yeah, just that. Sorry.
Yeah, Sheen, actually, I wanted to make a similar point what jury member have mentioned. The problem which I'm during the presentation, you kept mentioning that the literature says so, studies say so. Which studies? Like, have you referred to some literature on housing in India or housing in the Western world? So you haven't mentioned anywhere in your slides what is the source of your literature which says so. Somewhere you have mentioned that you have done some kind of a primary study with a sample size of, say, only 17, but it is not reflecting anywhere in your slides. The way you are presenting your results, it's like you're giving a statement which is coming from studies. And what are those studies? That is not reflecting anywhere in the presentation. If it is there in your paper, I don't know. I haven't gone through that in detail. But it is not reflecting. And then there is no credibility of that research if you don't mention the source. Even for the framework which you are presenting it here, is it derived by you or is it from a literature like Rockefeller Foundation, which you have mentioned? Only on the slide there is a source. So is it from literature or this is your framework? You have derived these indicators.
Yeah, the quote is from the document that we've mentioned.
So this framework you are using from literature. You're using these parameters from literature as the basis of collecting data. But what data have you collected? You're getting my point. We had a number of discussions on your topic. So I'm surprised that why there is no mention of literature anywhere on any of the slides. Studies say so. Which study? There's not a single mention of those studies. Is it there in your paper?
Yeah, ma'am, they're all there in the paper.
Then it could be a direct something from the studies which are very similar, like Sudipto said that A.B. Lowell and others, they have worked on similar this thing, and I think I had recommended you those studies. So how will we know that this is not a direct, like you have picked it up from there and you have done some efforts that is not coming out in the presentation? And I'm sorry to say that on final jury day, I'm saying this because I'm surprised that why this presentation is coming like this with no credibility of what you have done.
No, actually in the paper, the references are there. So they've mentioned A.B. Lowell and they've mentioned Korea, where they have taken the quotes from them. It's only that's the...
On the slides...
Yeah, it's on the slides, perhaps they're not there. And this in the wheel diagram, that was where there's a little confusion. How much of it is yours? How much of it you've compiled? And it's good that you've compiled, but it's very important that you mention these sources so that we know that there is some credibility in our actions.
Right, ma'am.
It's very important to mention the sources, like in previous groups also, where you are saying that you have done some kind of a survey. It should reflect in your slides. You have gone to the site and it's very surprising that you didn't even took a single photograph. Like somebody, some groups have come up with that kind of a comparison, but there's not a single photograph of the site visits. And that questions your research, whether it has been done or it has just been made up, the survey data, the results that you are doing. Okay, it must be there in your paper, I'm sure. But this is for every group that you cannot present it on the final day with not a single mention of the source.
Thank you. It also appears that we have a question for the team. I'll just read it out now. Kindly elaborate on the survey size and how the percentages of analysis were derived.
Right. Raman sir, we already answered this once, but I'll repeat it again. So what we had done was, we had made two different survey forms correlating to each of the dimensions, and both of those surveys got about 100 responses each. But there was difference in the number of responses from the high rises and low rise. Like the high, most of the, like 75% of the responses came from high rise buildings. And this skewed our results because of the difference in sample size. So our guide suggested us that we should, like, for example, if we have 20 results from low rise, we should only consider the first 20 responses from high rise as well. So there's some, so that the sample size is equal.
I heard that. My query was, Sheen, the percentages that were mentioned regarding to ventilation, daylighting, They seemed very straightforward.
So we wanted to like find out about the operational energy requirements, you know, like what is the existing scenario about that. So we asked people for how many hours a day do they rely on air conditioning in both the typologies, or for how many hours do they not need to switch on the lights, like that.
Yeah.
So how much energy they save, that was the aim of those questions.
And since all of you are living through a housing semester, you would equally appreciate that their answers would come from their understanding, whereas such parameters are equally impacted by orientation, the design, the fenestration design, so much more, right? So, and even their lifestyle choices, the manner in which they choose to have their air conditioning set points. Now, that's precisely my suggestion here, is that when we present something and we show numbers which are like 60%, 62%, and then 68%, and then make them lead us to certain conclusion on a sample size which has its challenges the way you have mentioned, it suddenly becomes that, you know, are we really hitting the nail on the head? One starts questioning, kya ye sachai hai kya? Are they the right pointers? Because we haven't analyzed their plan forms. We haven't gone deeper. So think on those aspects also. Are they the right pointers? Another aspect, I fully agree with the jury member, Mr. Sudipto's standpoint, that many a times such things are very regional. The geographical location aspects of housing and the comparison of high rise versus low rise. Well, intuitively, we all know what is right, what is not so right. But here, your exercise was to bring a more methodical approach in arriving at the same conclusion. Okay. Say for an example that we all have seen that in past 5 to 7 years, the incidents of cyclones and have really increased world over, right? Every year we have 3 or 4 big ones coming. And it's the coastal towns across the world which are really finding themselves exposed to wind speeds of above 165 to 200 kilometers per hour. Now you would, if you, your study could have taken another dimension wherein the construction aspect of a high rise, the challenges that a high rise faces with respect to the wind speeds versus a small low rise, especially it becoming a reality worldwide now, that suddenly would have led you to a very pragmatic takeaway. The fact is that the moment we go high rise, the wind speeds, they increase geometrically. But we can never really inbuilt our window panes, our glass sizes to meet those kind of once in a 50 years requirements. These are realities. So low rise stand above the high rise when you look at the provisions to face such calamities. Another aspect could be the carpet area ratio versus the built up area ratio of low rise versus high rise when you look at Indian context, where steel construction is still a rarity. It's essential concrete. The moment we go high, we really need to look at how the dynamics, the cost, the services impact the dynamics of even sustainability, ecological aspects. These are real-time data available on any high-rise projects. If they were compared with a low-rise, maybe G plus 3 or 4, you would easily be able to derive some factual aspects. That's the only observation I felt, that if you're really playing numbers, let's play them with a little bit more solid base.
Right, so like we mentioned, we didn't focus specifically on coastal regions or very earthquake prone regions or
we mentioned that we're focusing on parameters that can be generalized for a larger, like a wider area, so that, you know, it's applicable for whatever we develop the framework, it's applicable to a wider range of audience. For specifically, like if we say coastal areas, for them, they have one parameter which is very important for them, and the others have less importance relatively.
Sure. Well, one suggestion, Sheen, is that for your this study, which is on housing environment, and you're trying to compare one to the other, you could also look at Christopher Alexander's. He had kind of categorized certain elements of a building and how it contributes to human behavior, and it can be, and he had correlated it to housing, which then can be seen across scales, whether it's a high rise, low rise, or different mixed use patterns. And it's based on human behavior and architectural articulation, which you'll be able to relate to as architecture students of design. But that then gives you, need not be a very, you know, it's not always going to be calculated, but you can see how certain element, there are patterns in housing which repeat, because these are repetitive components of living units of different sizes. But there are certain components which, certain spaces which will always be constant, whether it's staircases, entrances, and he calls them as patterns. And, you know, they're not based on affordability or the size of the house, but, you know, and therefore they're also, to a large degree, it can apply itself to this, to now and earlier and future. So you can look at that model for analyzing something like this, which is generic, but also it's a housing study. So, and it can apply itself to different scales. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Also, like replying to Sudipto sir's earlier query, where he was like, we haven't proved that our framework actually proved enough that the framework actually corresponds to resilience. We'll make sure to take care of that in our report, and we'll elaborate how each of the indicators that we're mentioning, how they specifically contribute to the resilience of a housing community. And about the thing that you mentioned, that we can have a forest and then like a tall building above it, that's a like nice solution as like from us as designers. But in this study, we were trying to understand what's actually happening on ground right now. Right now, high rises, they have like high towers, but around them, there's just concrete pavement and parking. They don't have forests under them as of now, right? So we were just trying to analyze that situation.
Yeah, we completely understand that, and credit to you and your team for, you know, doing that and bringing this to a level where we could have this discussion, because, you know, unless we have good fertile ground for discussion, you know, this whole point of the seminar is lost. So thanks to all of you for creating this document, which allowed us to have this discussion. So yeah, I mean, I, you know, you have to take this as a you know, all of this is constructive criticism for you to for your next study. When you do it, you have a little bit of a broader sense of how to approach the problem. But you know, these are small building blocks for you as a researcher, as an academic. So I think these are great small steps that you guys are taking in the seminar. And then these will lead to bigger and better things for you. Okay. Thanks a lot.
Thank you for all the feedback.
Thank you, everyone, for all your respective comments and feedbacks. And thank you, sir, for that interesting question that you had posed. Now, I'd like to move on to the next group. So the housing sector contributes greatly to the carbon footprint, making it a key contributor to climate change. The rapid urbanization has left us no choice but to look at downsizing as a possible way forward towards sustainability. The upcoming group, in fact, tries to recognize the relevance of downsizing as a set of lifestyle choices rather than merely reducing the dimension of a space. The group tries to understand if downsizing can be part of a solution to a segment of the current scenario of the housing crisis in Indian cities by looking at the needs and standards of the newer generation. Let us see what they have to share with us about conceptualizing downsizing in an Indian context.
Thank you, Joanne, and greetings to everyone. My name is Piyush Gehlot, and with me, I have Asmita, Shweta, Ashna, Ganesh, Shreyas, and Karun as my teammates. Today, we'll be presenting a study on the topic, Conceptualizing Downsizing as a Sustainable Way of Living and Analyzing its Feasibility in the Indian Context. As already mentioned, the research aims to understand the downsizing as a set of lifestyle choices, as opposed to merely reducing the dimensions of space. It also pivots around the trending housing patterns, particularly focusing on the millennials, now aged between 25 to 40 years. Millennials in India comprise 1/3 of its total population and 46% of the country's total workforce. Downsizing is a concept that is not limited to a reduction in the size or the number of bedrooms alone, but also embraces reduction in the size and maintenance of the yard or garden, and can include a reduction in the value of the house or even possessions. We wanted to find out if downsizing really goes beyond smaller spaces, what are the factors that influence these changes for the better, and what is the scope for downsizing in India? To do this and answer these questions, we start by analyzing the current situations and various views on downsizing. We try to understand downsizing as various reasons it is done for. For example, lifestyle choices, economic reasons, easier maintenance, easier accessibility for the elderly, etc. By analyzing the results, we will be able to define the scope of downsizing and its feasibility in the Indian context. Over to you, Ashna.
Thank you, Piyush. Coming to the contribution of the housing sector to climate change is the most important issue of our time, and we are at a very crucial stage. The effects of climate change can be seen in various forms, from altering weather patterns, endangering food production, to rising sea levels. India is the world's third largest emitter of greenhouse gases, accounting for about 2.46 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide, which is 6.8% of worldwide emissions. The housing sector is responsible for about 5.5% of it. Cooking fuel is the most significant contributor to the rural carbon footprint, whereas electricity and travel are the most significant contributors in urban regions. The residential sector accounts for 28% of emissions of major Indian cities. The average per capita household CO2 emission in a year for India is 61 kg and 161 kg for rural and urban areas, respectively. The overuse of resources for building more than what is required, just because one wants to, challenges the whole idea of sustainability. The need to conceptualize need over want of spaces is of utmost importance in the housing sector. When we talk about the trends in global urban population, 30% of the world population lived in urban areas in 1950, 55% in 2018, and it is expected to reach 68% by the year 2050. In the context of India, the country is rapidly urbanizing and cities are challenged by urban growth and continuing poverty. About 40% of the Indian population in 2030 would be living in urban areas, as against 30% currently. This urban population growth will result in increased demand for housing, but the affordable housing deficit in urban India is at 47 million units. Over to Tarun, who is going to talk about the viability of downsizing as a solution.
Thank you, Ashna. Downsizing and right-sizing of Indian households could provide some relief to this housing crisis. According to a study conducted among 80 tiny home downsizes in the US, the average ecological footprint was 3.9 global hectares, which is substantially less than the average previous ecological footprint of 7 global hectares. So, one could conclude that reducing the living area does impact the ecological footprint of the individual. Almost all the housing shortages in the Indian cities are in the LIG and MIG sectors. Despite the housing crisis, a lot of the residential supply in the private sectors caters only to the MIG and HIG demand. This is made worse by the high unoccupied housing stock in the MIG and HIG sectors. This study focuses on the upper middle class and the higher income groups, so as to persuade them to consider downsizing as a way forward. Millennials make up 1/3 of the Indian population and 46% of the workforce. So they were considered as a prime demographic for the study. Millennials look for a neighborhood, not just homes. They want apartments within city limits. They want a locality with better amenities and in close proximity to their workspace. Therefore, they prefer smaller units that are more affordable. They prefer working from home, well-designed storage and multi-purpose spaces. And downsizing can cater to all these needs. A lot of millennials have high student loans. They delay marriage and have fewer children. Ergo, they have smaller families and lead to a reduced budget for housing. The reduced cost of downsizing allows them to not be tied down by mortgage and live with fewer debts. They get to work fewer hours and spend more time with their families and for their hobbies. Due to change in the millennials' housing needs, there is a shift in the housing market in the past decade. The chart here depicts this change. Although downsizing is happening in major cities, it is generally a consequence of economic constraint. It hasn't yet become a often surrounded by a negative connotation, creating a psychological barrier. Over to Shweta, who's going to talk about the overall methodology of the research.
Thank you, Tarun. I'm going to talk about the multi-method approach of research that we followed. We conducted surveys and interviews as primary research and used existing literature and case studies as secondary research. The first stage consists of understanding and establishing the nature of downsizing and its ecological impacts through existing literature. We then went on to look at case studies, both internationally as well as in India, recording the target group that it appealed to the most, the factor that made them downsize, and the design and lifestyle changes involved. Based on the data from case studies, we made a survey that shed light particularly on the current state of downsizing in India, its popularity, possible participants, and its obstacles and the factors that would lead them to downsize. The survey brought us in contact with people who downsized, who we further went on to interview. We also figured out what would make the others who'd been downsized potentially downsize. Through the survey, we narrowed down on a particular demographic, being the upper middle class and the HIG millennials. Interviews were conducted with the demographic to figure out their lifestyle needs and the day-to-day usage of space, based on which we mapped an activity chart to redefine the brief of a house. These interviews collectively provided us with people's views on downsizing. Apart from which, we also talked to architects to understand how how design can evolve to address the evolving needs of people as pointed in the chart. Combining people's views, architects' views, and developers' opinions from the current trend, we try to arrive at a potential way to redefine the housing typology. Over to Shez, who's going to talk about how we went about our analysis and elaborate on how the case studies have helped us.
Thank you, Shweta. Various case studies were studied, a survey on downsizing was conducted, and through activity mapping of spaces through interviews, the situation was analyzed in the Indian context. We have approached the case studies through four ways with both Indian and international case studies. Approach one is the economic decision that is by force, probably due to disasters and financial crisis. In this case, the house was downsized with certain design changes using dynamic furniture, which then resulted in freedom of movement, had more time to spend with family, and upgraded their lives. Approach two is also economic, but here the driving force would be to save money by moving closer to the workspace, making it a voluntary decision. In both the Indian and international case studies, the houses were downsized by making design interventions, such as adding extra storage units, multi-utility of spaces. This also resulted in amenities being within reach, reduced bills, increased time spent outdoors, and reduced petrol usage. Approach three would be for achieving environmental sustainability. From the Indian and international case studies, it was evident that the houses were downsized, sustainable and solar-powered construction was used, tall ceilings for natural light and ventilation, open floor plans, and flexible furnitures were some of the design interventions that were used. Approach four is downsizing through shared living that supports better social interaction and better amenities. Here too, foldable furnitures were used, just adequate bedroom sizes were some of the design changes that were inculcated. This aided in decluttering, buying only the necessary items, and consciousness of water and electricity usage. Lesser privacy, small habitable spaces, and losing out on hobby spaces were some of the downsides in this case. Over to Ganesh, who will be talking about the survey results.
Thank you, Shreyas. We conducted a survey of 180 participants in Tier 1 and Tier 2 cities in India. The age group has been kept broad to gauge the impact of generational ideologies on their perspective on downsizing. A majority of the participants live in a house with an area of more than 1,000 square feet. This generally represents the upper middle income and high income groups. Almost half of the participants were against the idea of discarding unused positions, and only 25% admitted that they might have underused spaces in their house. Space congestion and the lack of storage spaces were the main factors that discouraged them from downsizing. Many of the participants admitted that they would downsize for better amenities, easy maintenance, and more open areas. Most of the participants who have recently moved have moved into a bigger house, but there are a considerable number of participants who have downsized too. Most of them downsize due to financial reasons and for better facilities. Many of them downsize into their own house from a rented one. They have moved closer to work and have better amenities. They also find it easier to maintain. Over to Shweta, who's going to talk about the process of activity mapping.
Thank you, Ganesh. We conducted activity mapping as one of our research methods in order to redesign the brief of a house as per the requirements of a person. With an evolution of space with generations, spaces such as prayer rooms and storage rooms, which are not often used or wasted, disappear in millennial homes, and this resizing leads to downsizing. Our first step was tracking activities. Understanding the spaces that are actively used in a house by tracking the activities that happen in each space throughout the day. Second step was sizing spaces, optimizing the size of spaces based on their use and requirements. Why was this approach adapted? This was an attempt to rationalize the need for downsizing in India without thinking of it as a compromise on space or forcing people to downsize. Talking about the process of downsizing, we began with dividing the day into four major time frames and noted the number of individuals in the house. We then recorded the time spent by each person at home on an average. We tracked the space used and the activity done by each individual in the house at all times. We then listed the spaces in the house based on their function and made bubbles that are indicative of their area. These spaces were categorized as used, unused, and sometimes used based on the activities performed in these spaces. The removed spaces are indicated in dotted lines as shown here. As the next step, we do comparisons between standard spaces, sizes, and optimized sizes through a bubble diagram. Based on the inferences that we gathered from the interview of day-to-day activities, we began to add, subtract, or combine spaces as required. A couple examples are, the guest room is unused. So the study that's often conducted in the guest room can shift to the bedroom as an extension. And relaxing is generally in the bedroom, so the living room can shrink in size. The diagram here indicated shrinking spaces as two dotted lines, added spaces in yellow, and disappeared spaces in dotted lines. This is an example of the activity mapping conducted. The example is a house of 1,600 square feet with four people and three bedrooms in Jodhpur, Rajasthan. We drew a bubble diagram indicating the areas. While a couple spaces remain the same, the living room grew in size. The open to sky space, bedroom, and bathroom disappeared. The guest bedroom is removed as it's mostly unused. But to compensate for the living room, that increases in size and becomes more flexible. The open to sky space, which is not used or it does not have any specific purpose, can be taken away. Over to Ganesh, who's going to talk about the impact that this reduction of space creates at a neighborhood level.
Thank you, Shweta. We have an exercise to help you understand the impact of downsizing at a macro scale. With simple alterations using the activity mapping exercise explained by Shweta, we were able to reduce the size of a 100 square meter house to 89.7 square meters. This reduction, when done for an apartment with three 10-story towers with four dwelling units per floor, there results in a reduction of 1,236 square meters. This is equivalent to 12 such dwelling units. When this exercise is done at a neighborhood level, considering a neighborhood with 10 such apartment complexes and 50 low-rise flats, it leads to a reduction of 14,420 square meters, or the equivalent of 144 such dwelling units. To conclude, the exercise helps us understand the potential of a brief that has evolved to fit the needs of the new generations. The saved space results in enormous savings in terms of construction costs and embodied energy related to construction. The saved area can be utilized to provide community facilities or can be used to create housing for the groups of the society which cannot afford to live in cities due to the existing urban housing typology. Over to Asmita, who is going to talk about the findings from the study.
Thank you, Ganesh. So as Ganesh explained the impact that extra 10 square meter has on the environment, we can clearly understand that there is a need for redefinition of space that becomes the center stage in redefining this emerging housing typology. To begin with, when a space is defined by a specific purpose, it gets restricted by either its notion, physical partition, or furniture. The same space can be used for numerous purposes by integrating functions and employing the concept of multifunctional spaces. Second is the idea of flexible spaces. By bringing in the definition of partition, which brings in visual and acoustic security, a space can even change and adapt to various stages of life. For example, a space functioning as living room during the day can convert into a sleeping space at night. In short, understanding space according to its time and frequency of use is the key. While buying a home, one always thinks of the future. So the house has to be a space that can upsize or downsize. This can be achieved by using dynamic furniture such as Murphy beds, folding chair, collapsible storage, etc. We can also optimize space by using areas such as space under the bed or staircases for storage instead of opting for storerooms. The concept of shared living is introduced to cater to the evolving needs of the newer generation. Sharing certain facilities allows a reduction in the overall building footprint and encourages social interaction. In the end, we can say that it isn't about downsizing or upsizing. The size of the house should be according to the size and need of the family, which in most case was downsizing. The alternatives above clearly suggest once we start optimizing our living spaces, the living standards improve in terms of livability, equity, sociability, and sustainability. At last, we would like to say that going tiny doesn't always imply a major reduction in house size. It refers to recognizing the difference between need and want, trying to move away from the materialistic lifestyle and taking a step towards sustainable behavior. In the end, we would like to thank our guide, Kanish Prasad, for guiding us throughout this research. We would also like to thank everyone who helped us and guided us through this entire study. Thank you.
Thank you, team, for your presentation. Now I'd like to request the jury to give their feedback and comments on the presentation, and for the audience to place any questions that they may have in the chat box.
Rahul, you want to go first?
Okay. I think it's very interesting, your topic and your presentation. Some of the aspects of this dynamic slides is also very interesting, because it just shows that it's the what you're dealing with as a housing or a house is not a static object, and it's to be lived in, and the process of living in it is what we are calling as right sizing, or arriving at a balance, which itself is not constant, you know. So if at least in the Indian situation, where we have a habit of owning a property and inheriting it and then passing it on, it is a different situation. Whereas if you're in a social housing situation where you're allotted a home based on your requirement, then like you're saying, sustainable housing, let's say, it's a part of and everybody believes in the same sustainability concept, and you choose to live in a smaller house if you don't have a requirement for a larger one, and then you move on to a larger one when you have a bigger family, etc. So they know there's two completely different kind of social systems which can generate this it will then generate a kind of city that you're trying to project, that if you convert them into numbers, it becomes a certain kind of a built form. But nonetheless, it's very interesting the way you put it together, and the whole thing of want and need is another aspect, and you know, and everything exists. There is an American size and there is a Japanese size, and that is the dichotomy we are facing, you know, how big to make it, how compact to make it. And it's very, and for us it is all defined at present by our wallet. So you will find in an apartment, in most expensive apartment of Gurgaon, where you know you might have the right thoughts and the education to define sustainability and understand it, you'll find where the designer has to apply his mind is really when you're dealing with a very compact space. And when you have a very large space, you are often you try to fill the space in with imagined activities, So there is a huge on, you know, how do you make it real is a challenge. That's one. Second is this concept of what you're presenting is very fresh. It seems very fresh, but if you were to look back at your traditional housing, maybe it does the same thing. And there is lots to learn even from there of how there's a multiplicity of the spaces that are made for living. So are they defined as specific rooms, or are they defined only as spaces, or they just they have certain indicators in the way they are made that tempts you to use them in a certain way? You know, so you mentioned, I think in one of your case studies, I think when you were showing your slides, I thought you were indicating something in a traditional city. I got the sense, I don't know if you mentioned it like that. But, you know, even if you were to look at even a building element there, it allows you to do many things. Quite like your, like the way you're showing your furniture elements. So it's very interesting, and I think it applies to earlier architecture and even today, and this whole idea of multiplicity of use is what you could also aim to call it. Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, I've got a, I'm giving out marks in terms of topic relevance, and I think this is a topic which is getting maximum number of points for that, because it's really, really, it is relevant, and it's as Rahul said, it's very interesting as well. There are a couple of things that I picked out, which I have to go back to just a second. In your paper, there are, of course, you know, the millennials and how you've defined millennials. This is something that requires a little bit of attention. You've clubbed them also with baby boomers, retired baby boomers of 50 years old and above. This is an American concept, context rather, and I think it needs more contextualizing in India. The idea of downsizing, and as a definition, I think it needs to be added into the National Building Code or something like that, because it's really a relevant word. You know, coupled with frugality, coupled with compactness and other things, there is an ideology that goes alongside it. So your definition of downsizing leaves us a little bit dissatisfied or still hungry for a little bit more. In your terminologies, you've said that downsizing is a concept that is not limited to a reduction in the size of number of bedrooms alone, but also embraces reduction in the size of maintenance of the yard or garden, and can include a reduction in the value of the house or even possessions. I think that this needs real, real kind of elaboration in terms, and this can become some sort of an ethical, ideological concept that one can build into various different ways of thinking about the way we design and the way we build. For example, the National Building Code, which is probably written in 2013 and 14, and then it was released in 2016, still has, you know, door heights of 2 meters, 7 feet or 2150 rather. It still has minimum floor heights of 2750 or 9 feet for habitable rooms and 2450 for kitchens. You know, these need not be, they're not written in stone, but this is what is guiding a bulk of building activity across the country. If you go to a place like Finland or Scandinavia, the people are 6 feet 3 inches tall, but their door heights are 6 feet 6 inches. And here we've got 5 feet high people and we want door heights of 7 feet, right? So there are these kind of things which have come from somewhere and landed themselves into our codes, and they are being followed blindly across. So yes, there's a need to look at these, to study them. Your participants in your survey, 183. And then I'm looking at the diagram, the pie chart, which says number of people willing to reduce house size and by how much, if you can somehow get to that diagram. But it's surprising because there are 76 people who said, no, we won't downsize. We are not going to downsize. So it makes you feel that either, you know, the idea of downsizing has not been communicated adequately, or there is some other hang up. And this hang up could be that, you know, how we say, no, I need more storage. No, I need a larger kitchen. So these are things that, so what are they getting in return has to be really elaborated in a survey. So if you are, so for example, for millennials, they know that this is not their last home, but you tell them that, you know, instead of a bedroom, we give you a sleeping pod, but you get large living space. There's a place for entertainment. There's a place for working from home. You get a very small compact kitchen, but instead you have a Taj chef who's delivering food to you. You don't have to cook, right? But the amount of money that you'd be saving just on real estate cost, on the cost of land and the cost of building would be enough to pay for this chef for the next 10 years. Now, if you put it like that, it sounds very attractive, right? And you have this small house. It's really close to your office. You don't have to spend 2 hours traveling by bus, train, car, metro to get to your place of work. And suddenly things make sense. So it seems like your survey have been better designed to give you better responses. We know that, you know, nothing is objective as a question. Every question has the answer already kind of prompting you in one way or the other. But so these are things that, you know, you could have integrated. Okay, sorry about this. Yeah, I guess that's pretty much it. If you have, I'll probably get back if something else occurs to me. But well done otherwise. Good job.
Thank you. So I would just like to add something about the survey. So earlier we were trying to see, we were hoping through the survey we would get a large amount of people who downsize, but later on we sort of realized that, okay, that is like the most idealistic case that people downsize that too willingly. So we had to make certain changes in the survey to make sure we have a sort of a backup that, okay, what if we don't get the number of a lot of people who have downsized, so that we know what we are doing later. So maybe that's why the survey, I do agree that it could have been a bit better designed because we were a little bit struggling while coming at the inferences when we got the survey back. So, yeah.
Thank you, Asmita. I would like to add one more point on this. So although in the survey, 75% of the people were reluctant. Once we asked, you know, we conducted interviews of millennials, and then once we explained to them, you know, the benefits, more people were willing to, you know, downsize for say amenities or being closer to work and the extra, you know, spendable money they get after that.
Thank you, jury, for your insightful comments and feedbacks. Now I'd like to hand over the stage to Ayushi to introduce the next group.
Thank you, Joanne. A lot of houses nowadays are built with sustainability in mind. However, a major component of the housing stock was constructed prior to the implementation of sustainability principles, although energy efficient new construction applications are an important step towards sustainability. The existing building should also undertake a retrofitting process to achieve the desired environmental impact. We invite the next group to tell us more about retrofitting of existing housing for energy efficiency. I request the team leader, Shubha, to please take over.
Good afternoon, everyone. Our topic for this seminar is retrofitting of existing housing for energy efficiency. Our guide for the same was Professor Manoj Mathur, sir. The team members are
it's me, Basham Pavani, Vivesh Manohar Ramtike, Kolle Srijan Balaji, Konda Shashikiran Reddy, Nili Samprakash, Sheikh Sadiq Rasool, and Shubha Jayant. We would like to thank our guide, Professor Manoj Mathur, sir, who helped us throughout the research in the group. Retrofitting is basically the addition of new technology or features to the older system. So when it comes to buildings, it involves the change in structures or other components to improve the feasibility and performance of the building. If I have to put it up in an easier way, I'd say retrofitting is adding something that was not supposed to be there at the first place in the building. So why should we invest in retrofitting? There are many advantages of retrofittings, like energy efficiency, building maintenance. It increases the value and productivity of the building, and even it reduces our environmental footprint. It even protects the building from flooding and other hazards. Energy efficient retrofits are a very effective way to contribute to the national and local climate targets by incorporating green practices and resulting in low carbon emissions. So the investments also have proven to be profitable for building owners as they ensure long-term financial benefits throughout the reduced energy bills. So the retrofits can improve health and life standards by upgrading the thermal comfort and air quality. So on an overall average, we spend about 90% of our lives in the buildings. So improving indoor air quality and the climate can bring very important in terms of higher productivity rates and better health conditions. So residential sector is one of the fastest expanding sectors, which is growing because of big population base, rising income levels, and increased urbanization, not only in India, but throughout the world. The percentage of homes with access to electricity has increased to 25% from 2001 to 2017. And so this is the graph of areas of the buildings in residential space to the energy consumption forecast. As we can see, the residential sector's area is widely increasing throughout the years. In the recent past, there has been very considerable interest in the use of renewable energy technologies as building retrofit measures due to the enhanced awareness towards the environmental problems, which the LEED and other rating systems have also been recognized. Bhivesh will be taking over from now.
Rating systems for residential sector in India. Let me tell you the predominant green rating frameworks in India, which are Econews Samhita. It aims to benefit the occupants and the environment by promoting energy efficiency in design and construction of single and multi-dwelling unit. It takes the construction details of various building envelope elements such as walls, roofs, windows, ventilators, and doors as input in dedicated forms, and based on the user inputs, the code compliance is evaluated. BEE, Bureau of Energy Efficiency. BEE created the star rating for existing structures as a voluntary policy instrument to mitigate negative environmental effect. The star grading system is based on building's real performance in terms of particular energy efficiency, and LEED, Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design. LEED is used to evaluate the environmental performance of a building and encourage market transformation towards sustainable design. The system is credit-based, allowing projects to earn points for environmentally beneficial strategies taken during construction and use of a building. GRIHA, Green Rating for Integrated Habitat Assessment. It is a rating tool that facilitates assessment of the performance of buildings based on nationally accepted conditions or benchmarks. IGBC, Indian Green Building Council. The rating system evaluates certain mandatory requirements and credit points using a prescriptive approach and others on a performance-based approach. The rating system is evolved so as to be comprehensive and at the same time user-friendly. Here comes a star rating plan for residential buildings for the period of 2018 to 2024. It is different for different climatic zones like composite, warm and humid, hot and dry, and temperate. Star rating is calculated based on EPI, and EPI is equal to annual energy consumption by built-up area. aim of the research. Our aim with study was to learn in detail about how energy efficient retrofitting works and how it can assist a building become more sustainable and less vulnerable by maximizing natural opportunities. The background review of this topic leads to our main research question. What is the underlying energy efficiency potential of retrofitting in India's residential sector? The study includes a brief overview of retrofitting as well as a full examination of energy efficiency gained through retrofitting in homes, as well as how retrofitting is utilized to remodel a home to incorporate all energy saving and sustainable solutions. Using passive techniques and natural modifications, retrofitting in dwellings reduces buildings' energy consumption. Long-term energy solutions contribute for buildings' long-term viability and lifespan. How Sashi will take on from here?
The research is followed out by the following objectives. To analyze the current scenario of energy consumption in the residential sector, the quantitative data from the pyramidal studies, low-rise, mid-rise, and high-rise housing, to find appropriate retrofits for three types of residential houses with respect to their climatic conditions, to apply retrofitting strategies in the three case studies, and find out the energy efficiency achieved. The research started with collecting literature, research paper, books, and other data available about energy efficient retrofitting and forming a literature framework and understanding. The research has been done in the following sequence. Individually studying all the aspects of subtopics, relying under the main branches of our research question, retrofitting, energy efficiency, and climate analysis. Later, the data of energy consumed by each teammate's house in every respective season throughout the year had been recorded. Then, three different types of houses, low-rise, mid-rise, and high-rise, have been selected. The collected information is then interpreted into quantitative data in Excel sheet to calculate EPI and base the models for each type of house, which are made in Design Builder. With the help of secondary case studies, the other research papers, a list of retrofitting strategies has been made to be incorporated into these models in Design Builder. Application of retrofitting strategies is done and the energy conserved using energy efficient systems, lighting, and appliances is calculated. Energy production using renewable sources have also been calculated using Excel. Simulations were run after the application of roof retrofit and envelope retrofit to calculate the difference in cooling loads and energy consumed, which is then incorporated with the Excel sheet and the EPI is calculated after the retrofitting. Now Sadiq will take on from here.
Yeah. So due to the pandemic, the primary case studies of already retrofitted buildings was not possible. So we checked the case studies online, but online only the retrofitted buildings such as institutional buildings and office buildings and commercial buildings were present as retrofitted buildings, but they weren't in the India. Most of them were outside India. So we have selected three buildings. Number one was Godrej Bhavan in Mumbai. Godrej Bhavan in Mumbai, in 2010, due to the high electricity bills, Godrej Bhavan in Mumbai was upgraded by retrofitting a green roof and high efficient light fixtures. And they have included train energy building management system to constantly monitor the energy use discrepancies. Number two, we have Shem Park Apartments in Chennai. The main objective of Shem Park Apartments was to construct sustainable homes to increase the awareness of green buildings in the region. The retrofittings they were useful to apply the high albedo coating on the roof, which reflects 85% of the sunlight, and in turn it decreases nearly about 10 degrees Celsius inside the building. They have used solar water heaters, and the 20% of the building materials were from recycled materials such as fly ash bricks, furniture and textiles, etc. 75% of the materials used for the project were locally sourced. Number three, we have BCL houses in Bangalore. The project has its own innovative approaches to architecture and project management. Sky gardens have been provided to enhance microclimate of the homes. Walls were made of fly ash bricks, which have thermal conductivity of 30 to 40%, which allows less heat to the interiors of the building. east and west facades were shaded and cross ventilation is taken care of and ensured ample daylight to the interior of the homes. Now, Shujan will take up from here.
Sadiq, slide is struck.
Is the slide visible now?
No.
Sorry for the inconvenience. I share the slide.
I will take you through the strategies which make building energy efficient. We categorized core energy efficient strategies into three, which are passive strategies, energy efficient system, and energy production. Improvement to the building envelope elements are generally termed as passive energy strategies. A building envelope is a physical separator between the conditioned and unconditioned environment of the building envelope. A building envelope includes roofs, subfloors, external doors and windows, and of course the external walls. Roofs are a critical part of the building envelope that are highly susceptible to the solar radiation and account for the large amount of heat gain and loss. A wide variety of energy efficient roofing systems have emerged. Some of these are as follows: thermal roof, solar reflective, cool roofs, green roofs, ventilated roofs, evaporative roofs, and photovoltaic roofs. Walls are a prominent factions of a building envelope and are expected to provide a thermal and acoustic comfort within a building without compromising the aesthetics of the building. Some of the strategies that can be applied on the walls to improve the energy efficiency and comfort level in the building are thermal insulation, structurally insulated panels, passive solar walls, and green walls, etc. Fenestration refers to an opening in a building envelope that are primarily windows and doors. The fenestration plays a vital role in providing a thermal comfort and optimum illumination level in the building. We listed down some of the technologies for the energy efficiency in fenestration, which are aerogel glazing, vacuum glazing, switchable reflective glazing for tight frame and airtight frames. After incorporating passive strategies, we will move one step further and see which appliances can be replaced with energy efficient appliances, as they help us in the conserving energy. Such energy efficient systems are LED lights and energy rated appliances and motion sensor appliances, which captures motions and turn off the light and appliances. After incorporating passive strategies and replacing appliances with the energy efficient appliances, we move further into energy production. In energy production, we will use renewable energy sources which are readily available to us, such as solar energy, wind energy, and biogas. Shubha will take over from now.
So the primary case studies that were conducted are as follows: low-rise building, mid-rise building, and high-rise building. Sam will take over from here.
Yeah. The first case study was conducted on a single family low-rise house located in Chittur, Tirupati. Tirupati is a region with hot and dry climate. The site experiences high temperature for most time of the year. The primary problem in hot and dry climate are solar roads through the external wall conduction and radiation through the fenestrations. Energy is excessively used to cool the interiors and energy efficiency is in reducing the cooling load. The area of the building unit is 232 square meters. The annual energy consumption table was made by creating an Excel sheet and using the electricity bills. The annual energy consumption came out to be 13,871.6 kilowatt hour. Using the BEE rating system, EPI was calculated, which was coming out to be 65.8 kilowatt hour per meter square. After analyzing the data collected, we found that the cooling appliances were consuming the maximum amount of energy, and the southern facades getting more radiation, sunshades and wall insulations and green walls help to reduce the radiation. In our case, we used the expanded polystyrene as an insulating material on the exterior envelopes and insulative paints on the internal walls. The solar energy can also be produced by using the solar panels. The area of the roof is large and therefore it's a major source of heat gain. To cope up this situation, roof garden has been installed on the roof, which helps in reducing the heat penetrate through the roof into the house. The other retrofit strategies used to make the house energy efficient are insulative windows, double glazed glass units, insulative paints, energy efficient systems, and LED lights. Now Shrojan will take over from here.
The second case study was conducted on a mid-rise house in Nanded, Maharashtra. Nanded falls in the category of warm and humid climate. The primary areas of concern in warm and humid climates are conduction, solar load through the fenestration, and cooling energy association with the removing indoor moisture due to the people latent loads, ventilation, infiltration, and moisture ingress. The area of the building is 57 square meter. The annual energy consumption was 4,814 kilowatt per hour. And EPI was calculated to 78.67 kilowatt hour per meter square. After analyzing the data collected, we found out that cooling appliances were consuming maximum amount of energy. In this case, we used a living wall which cools the air in warmer summer months and changed window glasses from single glazed to double glazed on the west facade as it was gaining the more heat. Insulation has been improved both inside and outside to cope up with the moisture. Maximum heat gain was through the roof. So we created a roof garden and extra shading system which not only decreased the heat gain and also created the gathering space for community. The other retrofit strategies used to make this house efficient are insulative paints, energy efficient systems, and solar panels. And we used a biogas digester which also produced electric energy and heat energy for the heating the water and other works. Now Shubha will take over from now.
Yeah. So the third typology, that is the high-rise multifamily housing. It was located in Ghaziabad, Uttar Pradesh, and the climate type is composite. Sati, can you scroll the slide?
Yes.
Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Yeah.
So this was located in. Climate. Composite climate changes from season to season, often between hot and dry, warm and humid, and coarse. In composite climate, with high seasonal variations in air temperature and humidity, the buildings tend to consume energy all year round. This shows the energy consumption. The area of the unit is 103 square meter. Annual energy consumption is 18,080. And the EPI was coming out to be 141.25 kilowatt hour. Yeah. Looking at the climate graphs, we could tell the temperatures are high during the months of July, August, September. The days are sunny for most time of the year and indicates that there's a good scope of using solar energy. Wind speeds are also fairly high due to the reason of it being a high rise. Cooling appliances, the graph shows cooling appliances uses the highest amount of energy followed by the heating devices. So these were the strategies that were used in this type of building. Energy efficient glass in sliding doors and windows, insulated doors and windows, solar panels on west facade, insulative panes, efficient appliances, LED lights, energy efficient lifts, solar panels, and wind towers. After the applications of energy efficient strategies, we were able to find and calculating the efficiency, we were able to find out that we were able to achieve 55% in a low rise typology, 42% in a mid rise typology, and 57.5% in a high rise typology. To conclude this, retrofitting existing homes is a cost effective way to improve energy efficiency rather than building a new one. With the increasing population in the residential sector in the coming years, we need to realize the importance of retrofitting in the existing residential buildings, as there is a lot of potential for energy conservation in this sector. The first step towards sustainability is to have an empathetic approach towards our environment, and retrofitting can be one of the possible ways of making a positive impact on environment. Looking at the energy efficiency, one house might appear to make a less impact, but if we take a step back and look at the bigger picture, the scope of energy conservation is immense. I hope we were able to bring forth the importance of retrofitting in the existing residential buildings. Thank you.
Thank you, team, for your presentation. We now invite the jury to give the presentation some feedback and their comments, and also for the audience to post their questions in chat box.
Thanks for your presentation. Also, thank you for producing a very compact and short paper. When you have to read 243 pages for, that's about 24.3 pages on an average. You guys have downsized it to 17 in the words of your previous group. So thank you for that. It's good to have a compact paper rather than, you know, a verbose one. So I was just checking up on the net something. You know, you guys have made a very compelling case for retrofitting, where you've shown the amount of energy saved. Now, for this to become now successful, you guys have to, seven of you have to come together, form a company, which would be called retrofittersindia.com. And I've seen that it's the domain name is available. You can take it right now. But you know, the idea is that you still have to sell it to people to do this, right? So they have to look at this and say that, okay, you know, how much money am I going to spend to retrofit my house? And what is my payback period, right? So, and then when you make it a company, then you will of course be calculating the cost. You will be seeing, okay, how can I get thermal insulation for the walls at the lowest possible cost, right? And then you will, instead of EPS, perhaps you will look at recycled plastic, which is almost a waste product. Or instead of looking at a terrace garden, you'll probably look at just earthen pots that you can keep on the terrace with a little bit of a raised metal stand or something like that. Point being that, you know, it's very easy to come and say that, you know, put triple glass instead of single glass on the west side and save energy. But how can we do this in a manner that it becomes very attractive to people, for them to adopt it and make it into a movement of some sort? So instead of double glass, can I recommend, for example, external blinds, which, you know, earlier we used to call them cheeks, external cheeks, and they would do perhaps a better job during summers. And during winters, when I need the sunlight in my house, I would, you know, raise it, and I will still get a lot of light and sun and, you know, heat inside the house. So I think the point I'm trying to make is that you have to take this one step further and say that beyond energy, there is another way of looking at this, where retrofitting has to happen in a manner that it becomes attractive for people to adopt as a concept, as a way of building, especially when, you know, you look at housings which are now 30, 40, 50 year old. They are coming to the end of their lifespans in terms of life of concrete being 50 years. Of course, we stretch it to about 60, 70 here in India. But, you know, there's a whole generation of housings made by DDA, for example, which are now in coming to an end of their lifespans. Now, what happens to them? What happens to them in another 10 years when they become unsafe suddenly? The concrete starts falling off or whatever. Whether that would happen or not, but there's no real action plan for, you know, people, how they would break those, let's say, many, many apartments in Vasant Kunj, in Alaknanda. What would happen to those apartments once they leave, they reach the end of their lifespan, is a question that we don't have answers for. How does the ownership of those apartments, how they get transferred? But perhaps retrofitting can also extend to increasing the lifespan of a building. If you do a proper waterproofing, you can save, you can extend the life of a building by another 10 years, perhaps. So retrofitting, not just for energy, but also for life, because you increase the life of building, you prevent another new building from getting constructed. And therefore, by that way, you've already saved some carbon footprint right there. So those were my comments. I hope you would look at that and do something with it.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Even at the, like, during the time of the research, we had this question that how would we as architect would make people believe, okay, if they're like doing a retrofit, it's something good to the environment, but it's not this way. It's always key. We have to portray it to them in a way that it's beneficial for them. They can get subsidy, they can save all the electricity bills. So it's always how you're portraying the thoughts and ideologies to the person in front of you. We look into the financial aspect as well.
Yeah, I think what you have here is very interesting as a topic, and it kind of makes it, the reins are in the hands of the owner. You know, I mean, this whole idea of retrofitting, renovation, etc., the inhabitants feel like they are in control, you know, and that is a positive thing. Compare it to the building industry that is overtaking the housing sector, whether it's and this kind of ties up with the earlier topics that you were discussing of downsizing and of low-rise housing and the value of it being replaced, and the good values of it would be replaced by high-rise housing. Now, all that is also related to the fact that we want these housings to be deemed unsafe, or the, at least the largely builder community would want it to be like that. You know, they still might have a lot of life left in them if you present them with this option of retrofitting and rejuvenation. Because otherwise, with the increased FAR, etc., all of that is very lucrative to change over. And it also brings with it a completely different typology and a different cityscape and a lot of building activity which might not be required. So I think this kind of a movement, if you can bring about by making this viable, there might be many takers for it, because one, there is the whole city has been built on that notion of low-rise, neighborhood-driven design. And with retrofitting, I think you should also look at it more as also, it's a great job done, which you've done sitting at home. Each of you have taken up your house, I think, at different climate zones and done it. You could take it up at a neighborhood level, because then it ties up with RWA, you know, every lane. If you, like Osadito was mentioning, these DDA housing societies and how it's shared housing, and there might be a elevator required. So a lot of people are coming together to organize an elevator. Then the thing that is not organized in DDA housing is water supply and water storage. So all these streets and the public spaces which have been designed for walkability have now been populated by water tanks. So, you know, these are things which people have found solutions individually to. More we can talk, you can think of them as retrofitted, but that these things might find a solution if you look at them at a bigger scale, at a community scale or at a neighborhood scale. Things like garbage disposal, security. So, I mean, there's a great opportunity here for you to step in, look at it even at a neighborhood level, which then brings about an economy of scale for a lot of the ideas of energy efficiency, lighting, water supply, security, garbage disposal, et cetera, you know. So gardening, urban farming, and these are all things which don't need institutionalization beyond families coming together. So I think there's a great opportunity that you should expand this paper to or a neighborhood level and then make it a drive. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
If I may just add here, you know, one of the things that we all architects lack is that we don't know how to speak the language that people want to hear. And perhaps this topic could also benefit from that standpoint. Everybody likes to hear about sustainability, but would they want to put their money there? Well, to make them put their money in that area, it has to be packaged, and the language of that appeals to them has to be spoken. And perhaps this exercise that you have done, very logical, step in right direction, is just following that one last step, that how to package it in a manner that everybody feels so excited, because it makes monetary sense also. It makes a lot of monetary sense for everybody, but it needs to be projected in that with numbers and with the right taglines. And there you are. So a good way, a good start, and wish you all the best. Yeah, maybe I really like the idea that was suggested. Go ahead and put make a startup with retrofits.com.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, jury, for your comments and feedback. So as we have learned from our last presentation, there are several ways we can improve existing buildings to make them more sustainable. And another common proposal towards mitigating climate change is the use of greener strategies in architecture and design. But where is it wise to use it, and where will it go waste? On that questioning note, we would now like to begin our sixth and final session of the seminar, Questioning Green. Moving on to the first group of that session, the building sector is one of the major contributors of climate change. No matter what the scale or context or resources put together, construction activity of any kind has a massive ecological impression. This awareness has increased dramatically in recent times, leading to more and more people wanting to build environmentally sensibly. In their study, the next group unveils the ecological impact of a green certified building through their seminar, Is Green Green Enough? I now invite the group to take over.
Thank you, Joanne. Good evening, everyone. We are a group of 7 people, and our seminar is on. The title is Green Green Enough. We are Ayushi, myself Tilak, Hardeep, Saurya, Mangesh, Sachin, and Shashwat.
I would like to start by asking that did any of you ever think that to offset the carbon footprint of a green certified building, it could take an area of forest cover double the area of an entire country? Well, yes, you heard me right. The illustration that you see on screen is the area of forest cover, double the size of Vatican City for an IGBC Platinum certified building. And this is just when we calculated the embodied carbon of the materials during the construction phase.
And with this question, we lead you into our research.
This is the same data illustrated as the footprint of the green building in terms of forest cover required to offset its carbon emissions of only the raw materials used. This mind-boggling finding during an activity in our third year studio compelled us to research into this with a scientific approach, and we are going to present to you the methodology devised by us to arrive at this result and also give you some food for thought. I now request Shashwat to take over.
We are all familiar with the phenomena of climate change and how climate change has been proceeding at an exponential rate. and most of it is due to human intervention. Tilak, can you move forward?
Yeah, sorry, I think there's a lag. I apologize.
According to NASA and the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, 2019 was the second warmest year. This graph shows an evident and clear and convincing trend towards warmer temperatures. And like the past 5 years have been the warmest in the recorded history since modern record keeping began. Global mean temperature data sets from Climate Research Unit, National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, Goddard Institute of Space Studies, and other substantial, other comprehensive studies show agreement concerning the progress and extent of global warming. Data from ice cores has been used to construct Antarctic temperatures and atmospheric CO2 concentrations over the past 800,000 years. The current CO2 concentration is from atmospheric measurements. The cyclical pattern of temperature variation constitutes the ice age or interglacial cycles. During these cycles, changes in CO2 concentrations track closely with changes in temperature. As the record shows, the recent increase in atmospheric CO2 is unprecedented in the past 800,000 years. While in the natural cycle, the CO2 concentration would have been 280 ppm, currently it's at 400 ppm. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change reports are prepared by teams of relevant researchers. The latest IPCC report has 5 scenarios. The very low emission scenario involves strong international cooperation with priority given to sustainable development and improvement of living conditions for all. This scenario meets the 1.5 degree Celsius Paris Agreement goal. The very high emission scenario extends to 4.4 degrees Celsius, and it would be a consequence of conventional development. Food security globally could be substantially undermined and with the temperature increase, and global population may peak and decline in the 21st century. The consumption of fossil fuels is one of the biggest environmental problems. We may think of cars and factories as the most obvious enemies, but buildings use a major chunk of the global energy, water resources, and they emit more than 35% of the greenhouse gas emissions. We all know of the greenhouse gases and the effects in the atmosphere. Because CO2 is considered the most important greenhouse gas, some greenhouse gas assessments or reports only include CO2 and don't consider the other greenhouse gases. This can lead to an understatement of total global warming. Carbon dioxide equivalent, or CO2e, is a term for describing different greenhouse gases in a common unit. For any quantity and type of greenhouse gas, CO2e is calculated as the amount of CO2 which would have the equivalent global warming impact. It then gets established that to mitigate the effect of climate change, one of the key objectives is to see growth and development by being sustainable and eco-friendly in our choices, or by going green. With this, I ask Philip to take over.
Thank you, Shashwat. So like Shashwat said, it's seen that the solution to all of this is going green. But what is green? At this point, we request the participants to share what they think are green. You could use the chat box, or you can unmute and speak. We have one response, a color. Any others?
So what I feel is green is related to something with sustainability.
Thank you, Graham. Yeah. And Mr. Gaurav has added a comment saying a certification. And Mr. Chanpreet says anything that uses less energy. Thanks for your comments, everyone. And with that, move on to the next question. Now you see a set of images on our slide. Can you please drop a message saying which of these are green and which may not be? We have a comment from Architect Gunjan Jain, which says growth. Please just drop a number of the images that you think are green. And yeah, 1, 2, 3, 5, and 8. Any others? Everything except 6 and 4. And we have a message from Gaurav that says 1, 3, 6, and 8. But you'll all be surprised to know all of them are green. And this brings us to the fact that the term green is used interchangeably and as a sustainability eco label and marketing term to describe goods and services, regulations, guidelines, policies that claim to do less, minimal, or no harm to the ecosystem. Presently, the term green has been so overused and diluted such that it has lost all meaning. Often, it's thrown around casually to sway consumer interest, intentionally or unintentionally. Now, this leads us to a question, to first understand what green is. The word green comes from the Proto-Indo-European word gr, which means to grow. The same root gives us the words grow, green, gray, grass, groom in English, and in Sanskrit, grasati, grasta, and grasa. And all of these words are synonymous in a sense that they all point to the ideas of growth, transition, or nourishment. The word green today means many different things, like one of the participants pointed out, obviously the color, or to be covered with grass, trees, or other plants. And at the same time, it relates to the protection of the environment, and there are many more meanings. Now, buildings are inanimate objects that they do not grow. So now, if you think about it, it's more of an oxymoron to put them in the same word and say green building. So the word green building, referring to a static built structure, is a deception because buildings do not grow. With that, I request Mangesh to take over.
Thank you, Tilak. Green buildings in India. In response to mitigating climate change, the Confederation of the Indian Industry adopted the green building movement in 2001. Though there is no standard established definition of the word green, the rating system adopted to certify buildings have devised on occasionally enhanced criteria under which the environmental impact of the building sector can be minimized. Some of the famous rating system in India are LEED, GREEN, IGBC. These are the rating system are intended to quantify the environmental, economic, socio-economic benefits of the building's design with the focus of sustainable site planning, optimizing energy performance, efficient material and the construction practices, water and the waste management strategies, and indoor environment. In recent years, since the development of the green rating system, the focus has been on the minimizing the operational energy, the energy use that is visible to the building's tenant. Life cycle costing, on the other hand, is lagging behind the incorporation of the green buildings. The hidden components, which is not visible to the users of the buildings, embodied energy, can be contributed anywhere between 2 to 60% to the building of the life cycle energy consumption, and it varies with the intensity of the energy system that are installed in the buildings. Green buildings movement did not take into the account life cycle analysis in the impact of the buildings until recently. The reason why we are choosing focusing only on the embodied energy are the energy used during the building's manufacture phase is known as the embodied energy. It refers to the energy content of all material used in the structure, technological installation, as well as the energy consumed in the erection and the renovation of the structure. The energy content of the material refers to the energy necessary to get raw material, produce and the transport material to the construction sites. Energy uses produce the CO2, which contributes to the greenhouse gases. Hence, embodied energy is used as a measure of the building's overall environmental impact. Embodied energy must be accessed over the course of the building's functional life. And in many cases, a higher embodied energy construction material or the system may be justified since it lowered the building's operating energy requirement. Now I'll request Ayushi to go ahead with the research question.
Thank you, Mangesh. This brings us to our research question. Is building in adherence to green rating systems as a response to climate change assessed, analyzed, and its ecological impact reasonably acknowledged? Moving ahead, I will explain to you the research methodology that we went about to come to our solution. We first did a background study to understand green in terms of rating systems and its concerns regarding the climate change crisis. We moved ahead to assess what is the ecological impact of a green certified building in terms of carbon equivalent emissions. We compared it with two other cases when we altered the materials to a relatively conventional design and a lower GWP material design. We analyzed all the three cases and saw the carbon footprint and explained it at a scalable level. That brings us to a conclusion that are green buildings really the best solution to the climate crisis? I request Hardeep to take over and explain us the case study in detail.
Yeah, thank you, Ayushi. So the case study that we have taken up is Bricks at 47, which is a platinum IGBC platinum rated residence in Noida. It is a total of 550 square meters, and this is the plan. From the case study, we came up with three scenarios. First one, which will be the normal scenario, which was built using these materials, using AAC blocks and external cladding bricks. And secondly, we made, this is the graph that we came up with. Secondly, we made a scenario, which is the business as usual model, where we replaced the AAC blocks with kiln bricks and flooring with wooden flooring, etc. And this was the results that we came up with, which we'll show graphically comparing them in further. And we came up with a lower GWP value with the materials which have lower carbon, they release lower carbons into the environment. And this was the results that we came up with. And so as we see, per square meter of the building in generally, we release an equivalent of 328 carbon dioxide equivalent into the nature. In a business as usual model where we use bricks, we saw a rise to up to 607. And with the lowest possible, we were only able to bring it down to just 143. It sounds just, but when we look at the number of trees required to sequestrate it, we will see the how great that number is. So moving forward, I would like first to invite Mangesh to explain how are we going to sequestrate this.
Thank you, Hardeep. So carbon sequestration is one of the methods of reducing the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere by capturing and storing it. This process can be either natural using biological techniques or man-made using carbon capture and storage plants. So 45% of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is unabsorbed. That means the atmosphere still has a huge amount of carbon dioxide that is untouched. 25% of our carbon emissions have historically been captured by the earth forests, farms and grasslands. Also, the emissions are increasing and green cover is decreasing exponentially, hence reducing the effect of capturing the carbon emissions. 30% of the carbon dioxide we emit from burning of the fossil fuels is absorbed by the upper layer of the ocean. But it also affects the marine life because it pollutes the water of the ocean. So there are three types of carbon sequestration according to the methods used. First is biological sequestration that involves sequestration using forests, grasslands, farms, etc., which mainly involves biomass. Second is physical or geological sequestration that involves it by injecting carbon dioxide in the ocean beds and rocks or deposits of coals and oil reservoirs. Third is technological sequestration using carbon capture and storage machines, in which a machine sucks out the carbon present near it. It is already being implemented in some places, like one of the biggest machines recently turned on in Iceland. Now I would like to invite Surya to talk about why only trees, why are we looking only for trees for our research, and proceed further.
Thank you, Sachin. So why trees? Every year, trees absorb about 1/4 of carbon dioxide emissions caused by humans. Carbon makes up half of tree stems, branches, and roots. And when they die and decompose, much of that carbon ends up in soil, where it is stored for centuries or millennia. Carbon sequestration through trees is the most viable option because it is a stable natural process and acts as a long-term carbon pool. Even if a forest is no longer sequestering additional carbon or is sequestering at low rates, the carbon previously sequestered in biomass is preserved for a long time because wood decomposes very slowly and tree roots prevents erosion and subsequent oxidation of soil organic carbon. Compared to trees, next slide, Tilak. Compared to trees, other methods pose multiple limitations and challenges. Carbon capture and storage and geological sequestration on a large scale has great economic and technical limitations. Operational needs and transportation results in rise in fossil fuel use. Energy requirement of the mechanical equipment for the process would be significant. Use of the equipment for capture and storage would increase the per capita usage of energy, which automatically increases the cost of a unit of electricity. According to IPCC, carbon capture and storage will result in an increase of electricity generation costs by 1 to 5 cents per kilowatt hour. Another source of concern from storage facilities is carbon leakage. Hence, carbon sequestration through trees is being considered as the only viable sequestration method for the study. For our study, we refer to the data of carbon mapping study conducted by Konagar Municipality of West Bengal, in which we used carbon sequestration capacity per hectare of around 28 trees belonging to the subcontinent, such as coconut, neem, mango, banyan. And we arrived at an average per square meter sequestration potential. We used the said average to compare the embodied energy of the structures in our case studies. This will be further explained in detail in our case study results. Over to you, Hardeep.
So as we can see that in the different cases, the Brexit 47, which is our case study, and the business as usual model, where we taken materials that are available in market predominantly, and the lower global warming potential model, wherein we've used comparatively sustainable materials. So in the first case, we can see that per square meter of built area, we need a forest area of approximately 1,520 square meters. And in the business as usual model, we require 2,815 square meter forest area for 1 square meter built area. And similarly, in the third case, which is a lower GWP model, we need 663 square meter of forest for 1 square meter built area. We have a small video that illustrates our findings for the lower GWP model. We have different materials like concrete, brick, steel and glass, and the numbers are their global warming potential per kilogram. And this is how much of forest we need for a 600 square meter building. That brings us to the conclusion. Now, our research points to the fact that building in itself is not sustainable, since the impact it has on the planet is far too great to be compensated by the only viable means of sequestration, trees. But does that mean we stop constructing? The answer may be yes or may not be. But this points to the fact that a dependence on growth and construction needs to be relooked at. Global political orthodoxy declares growth is good and that more is always more. Economies based on increasing GDP come with increasing energy consumption, extraction of natural resources, and greenhouse gas emissions, all accelerating environmental collapse. The logic of economic growth commodifies everything in its path and creates an infinite loop which demands continuous construction of structures with no limits. The McKinsey Global Institute's report of 2020 projects a need for nearly 25 million affordable housing units for India by 2030. We made a small calculation of different type of units in affordable housing unit types. So we took EWS category, which is the economically weaker section, and then in lower income groups we have two types, which is A and B, and we distributed approximately 1/3 of each for the different categories, and we came up with a built up area of around 137 crore 37 lakh 50,000 square meters, Well, now this is a lot of area. Now, getting back to our case study, wherein we found that one square meter of forest requires, in the lower global warming potential model, 662 square meter for one square meter built area. We get an area of approximately 910,000 square kilometers. And similarly, when we compare it to the business as usual model, it which actually has higher global warming potential, leading to a forest area requirement of 2,800 square meters for one square meter built area, we end up with the requirement of approximately 31,87,000 square meters, which is nearly the size of the country. With that, I invite Ayushi to take over.
Thank you, Tilak. This brings us to the conclusion that if the present growth trends continue unchanged, the limits to growth on this planet will be reached before the year 2100. The most probable result will be a sudden and uncontrollable decline in population and industrial capacity. There will be an overshoot and collapse. It is possible to alter these growth trends to move towards an ecologically and economically sustainable future. The state of global equilibrium could be designed so that the basic material needs of each person on Earth are satisfied and each person has an equal opportunity to realize his individual human potential. But this is not something we are saying. The Limits to Growth, LTG, is a 1972 report by MIT that studied population and economic growth using computer simulation. When the study was being performed in 1972, the variables, population, food production, industrialization, pollution, and depletion and consumption of non-renewable resources was rising exponentially. The authors assumed that the variables would continue to rise exponentially, whereas the ability of technology to increase resources is linear. I request Shashwat to take over.
Visioning, networking, truth-telling, learning, and loving. These are the five tools which are introduced by the authors of LTG as helpful practices to move forward towards the enormity of the changes required. The authors acknowledge how these tools may make us feel uneasy due to their soft nature when we know that the future of the civilization is at stake. The greatest shortcoming of the human race is our inability to understand the exponential function. We must realize that growth is but an adolescent phase of life which stops when physical maturity is reached. If growth continues in the period of maturity, it is called obesity or cancer. Just as in architecture, we explore new design philosophies, aesthetic languages, and structural systems, we must explore alternative economies, other ways of structuring trade and assigning value.
Degrowth is a design reduction of total energy and material use to realign society within planetary limits, while improving people's lives and distributing resources fairly. It is an economic model that recognizes that the route to greater welfare for all is not one of more extraction and expansion, but of more sharing and cooperation. Degrowth is based on the idea that people should live simply so that others, both human and non-human, may simply live. It implies a linear societal metabolism of less material extraction, throughput, waste, and so on, which creates the conditions for supporting lives that merit the joy to be lived. However, this notion of a linear societal metabolism need not necessarily be interpreted as advocating for only less, but also something different. With that, we come to the end of our presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, team, for that presentation. We now invite the jury to give the team their comments and feedback, and for the audience to post any questions they have in the chat box.
Sir, you are on mute, sir.
How many times have I done that today? I was saying it's a very convincing presentation and very well thought out, well structured arguments. I mean, it does not leave you in any way searching for gaps or you know, answers. I think you've made very good suggestions as well, way forward, a way to think differently, and so on. Yeah, degrowth as a concept, which is societal metabolism, as you put it, seems like something that we need to actively think about. You know, we, as architects, of course, we always feel that we are not doing enough, and we can always do more. We feel that we are always at the end of a, the last decision is taken by us. You know, the what kind of building, who will build, where they will build, how much they will build, all gets decided even before we are brought onto the picture. At the same time, the burden of going green, the burden of becoming responsible for the world, kind of lies squarely on our shoulders, and one always feels guilty at the end. And you're right, this building is not sustainable. It's purely, it's like what you've shown today is that no matter what we do, we'll always fall short of it. And so as human beings, what do? Degrowth is one, definitely one way. And I was having a discussion with a friend of mine, and we were saying, okay, what have you done? You know, what have you done to help the environment? What have you done? And he said something, I've not had children. And simply that stuns everyone into silence, because, you know, as my previous generation did not tell me not to have children. Now, this is something that as I'm telling you here, this is something that as a generation forward in front of you, I would say that please don't have children. Just adopt if you have to, because, you know, that's what's causing this whole chain of events where we produce another individual who consumes exactly as much as you do, who needs exactly the same number of houses and the same number of cars. And it just goes on and on. So I don't think there is an answer to architects becoming problem solvers for a world which is clearly going down a path which is irrecoverable. But as human beings, we can definitely do our bit. And so as the new generation who can still do something about this, I would really hope and pray that you guys do better than us. I wish somebody told us better, informed us better. But yes, this is where we are.
I think with what Sudipta has proposed is an aspect of lifestyle choice. But I would think if you were to convert it to your research with building material, and I think that that's where you're aiming. So is there any, some of this research paper is, you put it together very well. It's just, I thought if you could put in some visuals and some actual case studies of case studies to support the material, which is building oriented or physical projects, that would enrich the paper and you know, give it a face to all the numbers and the research that you've put in. So otherwise it's very interesting what you've done. I mean, it might sound very regular, but you know, it's something that one looks forward to when one is looking at reading about a topic, then you can relate to it to the architectural space that we are dealing in.
It seems that we have a question as well. I read it out. So could you as a team come up with a condensed and concise actionable that is your belief to bring new meaning to sustainability?
I would like to answer that question. So we believe that we do not need to bring a new meaning to the word sustainability. The word sustainability itself has the meaning that we use the current resources which we have in a very thoughtful manner, such that we have enough left for our future generations. It's just that the word has been used
so widely and so loosely these days that it has lost its actual meaning.
Thank you.
Actually, if I can just pipe in also in from the side of the group, I think the answer to Raman sir's question would be no, very simply. Could you as a team come up with a condensed and concise actionable that is your belief to bring new meaning to sustainability? The answer is no. It's very simple. You have to get the question first. And Ayushi, you answered it, but thoda ghuma ke answer. Whereas the straight answer is no. There is no concise and short. I can't bring brevity to this problem. I mean, you've looked at the multitude of angles, perceptions, beliefs that go into the consumption pattern that snowballs into the result that you have arrived at today, right? So there actually isn't a concise answer to this. One has to look at the complexity of what the IPCC has put together to actually even begin to comprehend who all is important and where one starts pulling the string to be able to even arrive at some sort of a semblance of meaning to all of this.
Very true. I agree with it. It's very complex, interdependent, and highly ignored. And incidentally, the human interface, the way we make our lifestyle choices, are the most ignored of all. I'm fortunate to be part of many green building projects. Few of them have been industrial platinum rated buildings. And the lessons that I've learned is that any kind of green building initiatives that we do, they will always fall short. They are falling short. Now look at past two generations of IGBC initiatives, amazing number of square footage, millions of square footage. Has that changed the environment for good? No, it didn't make any dent at all. It's not to say that it is not the right thing. It's the right thing in the right way, but it's not reaping the right benefits, because every green building conference we have, after every session, there is a small plastic bottle water that is kept in front of the and at the end of three days, we have 500 bottles of plastic consumed by the delegates who came to mull over green buildings. Every green platinum building that I have designed has people who are firing print command on one side of the paper, while they know very much that by just making a choice, they can use both sides of the papers.
Yeah.
Every green building that I have designed has got halls. Well, there are sensors available, occupancy sensors, but wherever they are not used, there is one person, two people sitting in a hall meant for 15 people with 10 fans running.
Yeah.
There you are. These are 10 highly efficient fans. These are all LED lights, which are highly efficient, but well, they are running because the people can't care less. So time and again, my learning is it's not the green buildings, it's not the green smart buildings that we need. We need to wake up, become smart ourselves in a real way, and make lifestyle choices. And how could that ever be till we know that consumerism, the growth definition of GDP, like you so rightly said, is pulling us in a direction where even the concept of green is being commoditized.
True.
Green building is a big industry. Right. And we all know more than anybody else, Mr. Gaurav Shori here is an expert who knows the kind of big industry that is giving initiative. Well, fortunately, it's in the right direction. But again, should we go green just because we have to save climate? No, the earth, no, the earth definitely doesn't need saving. Earth will remain even after us. But the whole take in the manner we have been defining a green buildings for past three decades has totally taken off the responsibility from our shoulders of the choices that we make. Because we have money, we can buy food, and we can throw away the one which we don't need, is the root mindset of being ungreen. Until we do something about that, all these efforts will reap only marginal benefits. And this is not something I'm just saying out of sake of saying it. I've seen it built those buildings and then went there to see how people are using it and figured out, oh God, it could really make so much more difference if what we thought as architects could also be communicated, not only communicated, somehow be communicated in a way that it becomes their belief system.
Very true.
Because ultimately I'll go come out of that building after talking to them, but it's them who have to start, keep on using it for decades. Yeah. That mindset, that link of how to bring that shift in a common person, like I shared in the earlier session, that when BSCS sends me a bill and tells me, okay, you have performed well this thing and this is where you are relatively, somewhere that information is coming to me is how am I living today.
Yeah.
And there need to be parameters available. Maybe we as architects are not the ones who design those parameters, but when we have such discussions, it is important for us to figure out that we make only small, we are a link in the chain. And let's not believe that just being link, well, it's not unimportant to be a link in itself, but we cannot make an impact by on our own until unless this whole ecosystem, of which my daily routine is also an equally important part. So there is nothing to say that it's always somebody else who is to change. My only takeaway for myself was, you change yourself, your choices. And even if that is a small one, it's good enough.
Raman.
At least for my own conscience.
Raman.
Got it.
Yeah. Raman, do you segregate your waste? Raman.
Yes, ma'am, I do segregate my waste. My wife decided to not segregate it. I fought with her. She fought with me. And then she told me, look, aage jaake to mix hota hai hai. So then I went to the Dhalao. I checked with the people there who are there segregating the waste. Maine unse pucha ki farak padta hai, wo kehte haan ji. Then I came back, told to her, then we have to. Now the problem is segregating waste also in two plastic bags is a big solution I'm trying to find. Because I'm also buying those black bags to segregate the waste. So the answer is yes, ma'am. In our own little ways, one tries to bring those things. And that's where it's.
Got you. I got that. Thank you, Raman sir. Thank you for your feedback. So there's one thing I wanted to rant about. Sulto and Rahul, I'll just take 2 minutes. There were some things that this group had to cover in their study, which they haven't. And I want to just flag that. At the level of the country, we did want to explore why was there a very steady decline in the joint family system. And I would say the joint family value system, because the inherent incessant requirement and demand for housing also is a function of people leaving their older generation kind of walking out. Whereas when we look at what UK is doing or what Europe is doing, they're doing multi-generational housing. And they've also looked at longevity issues, impact, positive impact on health for elderly people as a method of kind of part of the degrowth proposition. So I would have loved it if you guys had also kind of incorporated that as a suggestion, because we don't need to appreciate multi-generational housing. It's not something new for us. If the UK has arrived at it full circle, it's something new for them. For us, joint family systems were an integral part of society till about 60, 70 or 100 years back, right? So why has the steady decline happened? Could that be a format of kind of nudging us towards retrofitting, adaptive reuse, and multi-generational housing to avoid the way we are constructing? Could possibly have made its way to your papers. So I did want to kind of point that out, that if you can some way incorporate it into the paper still, then it will be valuable.
Sure, Gaurav. And also it's not the end of the research, it's just the start.
It's a beginning. I like that. I appreciate that. Thank you very much.
And Gaurav, can you just explain a little more for my reference that how do you correlate that with this concept of sustainability? I have a sense of it, but I would like to hear your thoughts.
Yeah, actually, it got triggered in what Sudipto had said very rightly, that when his friend says, I haven't had kids, it stumps everybody, right? Because what you're effectively saying is that I haven't added to the burden of consumption on the planet by adding another life to it, right? Whereas if you look at the joint family system itself, there was this tremendous inherent system of reuse, like whether it was clothes or whether it was a vehicle or whether it was food or whether it was whatever it was, it got handed down from generation to generation. And what is now being called in the US, they're calling it BIFL, buy it for life, which is the latest phrase that they're using for, say, for example, all of us who use Bluetooth headsets, we should know that all of them are designed for the dump. None of them are designed to be reused. But companies like Bose are now coming up with BIFL products. Now, inherently, everything earlier used to be BIFL.
Yes.
तो ये बीच में 20 साल गैप कहाँ से आया, क्यों आया, where did this whole perception of designed obsolescence come into the picture? How does one remedy it? So I don't want to eat into too much of your time, but just creating social structures that allow for exchange goods and services within people rather than constantly buying new.
Yes.
As in the Amazon or the Flipkart model, can then again kind of work towards carbon abatement at a global level is what we're conjecturing.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, okay.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good job. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, everyone, for your valuable feedback as well as the question. Now, pondering upon similar lines, the next group shall ask, can luxury and green coexist in architecture? A rapid increase in population, wealth and lifestyle of people has put huge stress on the environment. The housing demands have risen despite pandemic leading to more and more homes being built, especially the luxury homes, as they remain unaffected from the pandemic. The group aims to understand the perception of architectural luxury, its environmental impact, and provide solutions for the same. Now let's see what they have for us today.
Thank you so much, Johan, for the brief discussion, introduction. So good afternoon, good evening, everyone. I am Ibrahim Neetawala, and today our topic is, can luxury and green coexist in architecture? So with me, my co-authors are Millennium Jivane, Mukul Bagoria, Stanzen Chostak, Keshav Raj, Pradeep Shura, Ankit Patak, and our guide is architect Gaurav Shore. So as the previous group threw light upon how adversely building impact the environment, and a time may come when we'll need to stop building. So we are here to discuss about a small yet effective step that can bring significant reduction in carbon emissions from buildings. So 39% of all carbon emissions in the world is through building and construction, out of which 28% is operational emissions and 11% is embodied carbon. Next. So according to IBEF 2021, home sales volume in India's 8 major cities increased by 2 times. This indicates a healthy recovery following the strict lockdown imposed in the second quarter due to the spread of COVID-19 across the country. So why we chose luxury housing? Despite the pandemic, luxury homes maintained their sales pace mainly because their buyer class was not affected as those in other budget categories. And the luxury housing sales in India, India's 7th biggest market, increased by 21%, owing to an increased desire for open and larger spaces as a result of COVID-19 outbreak. As a result, it's critical to comprehend the impact of luxury homes on the environment, as these properties contain more of high carbon emitting materials. Next. So with the growing awareness, there is a shift towards becoming eco-friendly and sustainable. Despite the evolution of sustainability and its concept, many architects, designers, and even users do not employ sustainable design strategies. Next. Mukul.
Hello, Ibrahim.
Present.
Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay.
So the aim of this study is to understand the perception of luxury and where it is coming from. To understand the role of interior designers and users in promoting sustainable approaches in interior spaces, and to find out the impact of interior finishes in terms of embodied carbon in high-end homes. Next, over to you, Keshav.
Thank you, Ibrahim. Our research methodology comprises of qualitative and quantitative analysis. A literature review was done to understand the better concept of luxury. Next. To further understand the perception of luxury in architecture, online surveys and interviews were conducted. Next. A case study of a luxury apartment was done for performing life cycle assessment and embodied carbon. Now, over to you, Millennia.
Okay. Yeah. So before we understand what is luxury, next. Yeah. Before we understand what is luxury in architecture, it becomes important to understand what exactly is the meaning of luxury and what is the key factor that drives it. Based on our surveys and findings, we came to a conclusion that luxury is a subjective term. What is luxury for me may or may not be luxury for you. It depends on several factors such as their income, lifestyle, aesthetic preference, quality, luster, and needs. Everyone has different levels and standards for it. But one thing that surely defines luxury is the feeling of exclusivity, the feeling that a certain product or experience that I have or own is limited and not everyone will be able to get their hands on it. Next. It can be seen in history of architecture that nobles such as Cosimo de' Medici, Giovanni Rucellai, and Doges of Venice imitated the Roman aristocrats, their luxurious lifestyle and building taste, to construct private places clad with imported stones and multicolored marbles. The idea about high level of refinement infused their architecture so much that their exterior of building showed the excessive display of wealth for the public. Luxury thus informs how overbuilding and architectural excess become permissible from history to modern era. In the present days, the luxury for architecture depends upon several things: the quality of space, light, tactile nature of materials used, and craftsmanship, etc. Next. Talking about the pricing of luxury homes, I would like to state Mr. Amit Goyal, the CEO of India Sotheby International Realty. The pandemic has changed the luxury home buyers' priorities. Private outdoor spaces or nearby parks and additional square footages for remote work and education have become the most important criteria for, and this trend will continue well into 2021. The pricing depends on several factors. The surroundings, location and the position of an apartment are the most influential factors that decide the selling price of the apartment. Second, the physical characteristics such as the quality of buildings, exterior finishings, interior decorations, quality of planning and design, etc. Third comes the quality of service such as the presence of smart home technology, services provided by management, etc. Fourth, the demographic factors, buyers' decisions are influenced highly by personal characteristics such as their age, occupation, economic circumstances, lifestyle and personality taste, etc. All of which add to the prices of apartments. Next, Pradeep will be explaining about luxury interior design.
Sustainable interior design, what is it? Interior design that combines all systems and materials to limit negative impacts on the environment and occupant while maximizing positive benefits on environmental systems, economic systems, and social systems across the life cycle of a building is referred to as a sustainable interior design. According to Alfieri in his paper on sustainable environment in interior design, sustainable interior design takes into account not only the environmental aspects of sustainable materials and solutions throughout their manufacturing and disposal processes, but also their influence on people's health and the environment while in use. Because materials are the major component of interior space components, material selection is a vital aspect in the interior design process, because they use quantity and distribution within the interior space may generate various design concepts. Materials might be regarded an independent design element. In interior design, sustainable materials are chosen based on the following features that are defined by considerations that reduce negative environmental impacts, that are local materials, durable materials, reused materials, recycled and upcycled materials. There are a lot of limits when it comes to selecting materials for interior design that deliver that needed performance and aesthetics while still being sustainable. Major limitations to this sustainable approach for interior design material selections are maintenance and durability. These functional aspects of material are important criteria in the selection process. Post, interior designers choose materials primarily based on the preferences of their clients' need, cost, and aesthetics, and not on sustainability as criteria. Time, easily access to materials data is considered an important factor in material selection. Availability, the limited availability of environmentally responsible material leads to the necessity of relying on imported materials with high embodied energy because of the transportation. Client's expectations. Is a designer's job to persuade the client to choose sustainable interior solutions by creating detailed design drawings and that best convey the design idea and informing them of the positive environmental impacts of sustainable interior solutions over conventional methods, all while meeting the client's functional requirements, aesthetic preferences, and budget. To persuade a customer to choose environmentally friendly interior design, the designer must persuade him that despite the high initial cost, it will save him money in the long term. Over to you, Mukul.
Thank you, Pradeep. Online surveys are conducted to understand the perception of luxury in terms of building materials, its selection procedure, and to learn more about the environmental consequences and climate change impact of choosing so-called interior luxury finishes in high-end residential category. The findings for Survey A are based on responses of 42 people of all genders and ages, most of them from Delhi, and of whom 55% are budding architects from one of the top architecture colleges in India. So what is luxury? For most people, luxury means necessary. When talking about luxury, so it also plays a major role, which most people agree to. As a result, a person's decision to choose an interior finish is heavily influenced by his or her family background and reputation in their social circle. Perception of luxury. Other major sources of luxury perception are celebrities and rich people's home, rarity, expensiveness, advertisements, royal looks, and as per the current trends. One shocking revelation was that no one thought of locally sourced materials to come under luxury. Maybe this means people have less awareness about locally sourced materials as compared to imported materials. Quality, rarity, aesthetics, and price are very important determinants for a material to be considered as a luxury. When talking about aesthetics, the floor finish and the interior wall finish are the two major areas in a luxury house that determines the overall looks, apart from furniture, appliances, and drapery. The majority have a perception that a high gloss finish looks more luxurious in the case of flooring and matte finish for the wall surface. From this, we learn what kind of aesthetics does people prefer. One of the major roles of the interior designer or an architect is to give the client suggestions regarding the interior finishes. The people who got their interior designs done from a consultant preferred their own choices over the consultant's advice, which shows that they hesitate to question themselves about their perceptions regarding interior finishes and are reluctant towards others' advice. In a perception-based question, when respondents were asked to select a bag of cement from brand A, which is more famous, and brand B, which is less famous, having same product make and very little price variation, majority went with brand A. This shows that brand value and marketing power also plays a major role in deciding people's choice. Survey B is based on the views of 20 renowned architects who have years of experience in luxury projects and also an interview conducted with one of the very famous luxury residential architects from Delhi. It is equally important to consider the views of architects and other consultants as they are the ones who are more exposed to the knowledge and practicality of interior finishes and can rightly suggest the notions and aspects of luxury related to it. 50% of them strongly agree with the statement that luxury means having more than necessary and suggests the average cost of luxury today is anywhere between 6,000 to 9,000 rupees per square feet. Unlike common people, consultants do not strongly agree that local luxury depends on just the social status, and also feel that people sometimes go above and beyond their financial capability to make their property more appealing. They also have similar views that quality, aesthetics, rarity, brand value, and price are very important determinants for a finish to be considered as a luxury. But unlike general public, few of them also favor locally sourced materials. Then ask about whether their clients demand eco-friendly materials in their homes while designing. The response is negative. This shows that it is difficult to break the perception of luxury in people's mind, and they are more inclined towards using highly finished materials with more embodied carbon. One reason for this could be market availability, as some consultants think that there are more imported materials in the market as compared to the Indian materials. As a result, there are fewer buyers as well as sellers of eco-friendly materials. Some of the market promotion strategies which are responsible for clients' perception are brand endorsements by celebrities, famous brand samples and appealing brochures, and what is used by famous people in their houses also becomes a trend and sells more. On the view of people's perception of luxury, the principal architect of Visarg Design Studio says, the bulk of the clients are very influenced by their trips abroad. There are clients who travel a lot and get influenced from what they see or from what they see on the internet, and also influenced by looking at homes of international icons and stars. That is where all this perception of luxury is coming from. Now, I would like Ibrahim to carry on forward.
Thank you, Mukul. So we conducted a life cycle assessment analysis to see how much impact can sustainable by using sustainable materials in a high-end building can make towards the reduction of embodied carbon reduction. So first of all, there are two types of carbon emissions associated with the building. One is operational carbon, that is the emissions generated during the operational phase of a building as a result of the operational energy used for HVAC and cooking and refrigeration, etc. Then embodied carbon. Embodied carbon is the carbon emission associated with energy consumption and chemical processes during the extraction, manufacture, transportation, assembly, replacement, and deconstruction of construction materials or products. So there are five embodied carbon emission stages: cradle to gate, cradle to site, cradle to end of construction, cradle to grave, and cradle to cradle. So why cradle to gate stage? So cradle to gate LCA is considered to be the most efficient, as 80% of initial embodied carbon can be reduced before construction commenced. As more carbon is committed into the project, the reduction potential decreases rapidly, as possible design solutions are constrained by previous design decisions. Then during construction phase, the reduction potential can be considered as nearly zero unless there is a design change. So the life cycle assessment. A life cycle assessment is defined as the systematic analysis of the potential environmental impact of products and services during their entire lifetime. So a 9-story luxury apartment tower with a floor area of 3787 square feet in Bangalore, India was selected for the case study, and the main building elements such as floors, roof, external walls, interior, internal partitions, and internal finishes were considered to calculate the embodied carbon in the study. And the emission factors were taken from the Indian Construction Material Database and Ecoinvent version 3 database. These are the database of environmental impact data for the most commonly used building products and materials in India and global. Then we created a design builder model, that is a building information modeling, that where all the data of the material goes into it. And then the simulations were run. So we replaced the existing materials such as imported marble finishes, wood laminated, wooden laminate finishes, with such as local materials like local stones that is available in India, like local stone. Aluminium extruded frames were replaced by UPVC frames. So we optimized it, and then we ran the simulation. So over to you, Mr. Anzu.
Thank you, Ivan. Coming to the conclusion, next. Green is luxury, says architect Rajesh Advani, founder of Architecture Life. The statement is truly valuable. Going for sustainable interior environment in a creative way is now considered an exclusivity that people seek in the high-end homes. Next. Also, in the life cycle assessment, we observed a significant drop in the amount of embodied carbon. To be specific, about 29%, which means luxury certainly can coexist with sustainability if the right approach for designing is combined with the right knowledge and right craftsmanship. Also, according to the survey conducted, 90% of the respondents agree with the statement that climate change will reshape the perspective of luxury, and using locally sourced or eco-friendly materials aesthetically might trend in future. This shows that people and architects do believe that coming times would have people looking towards sustainability as a luxury. Now, the way forward to achieve this target was mostly on the designer, as designers should focus more on creating designs and construction technologies that promote locally sourced and eco-friendly materials. Secondly, they should make clients aware of the negative environmental impact and consequences of using imported finishing materials. Thirdly, creative designs and detailed design drawings should be prepared for every project, and that best conveys the design idea so as to make them client agree to go for a sustainable interior environment. And last but not the least, influential people of the country should become more aware of climate change and demand sustainable environments on both the building exterior and interior levels, setting as a standard to others for follow. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, team. I now request the jury to give their feedback and the audience to post the questions in the chat box or the Q&A forum.
Rahul, you first. Completely disappeared. Oh, you're on mute. I'm still looking for that Amit Goel quote. I know I had something about that. Rahul, are you going first? Sorry, guys. I'm just trying to still collect my thoughts here.
I think Rahul's trying to log in from another device.
Yeah, I have.
Okay, you have? Okay, would you go for it?
Okay. So, I think at the beginning of the research, you were telling us how to market luxury and how people understand luxury and in general. I think one way of looking at it is that the design itself is a component of luxury, to have access to design, and a designer or a designed space is the first step towards luxury, which where you're hiring a professional beyond the fact that you have got a house which might have been designed. And for an interior space, you feel that there is another design professional who needs to come in and tailor make it for your needs. Now, often what happens is that the tailor making of the needs is that you have to define the needs for them, which we're in the privileged position of doing that. So that gives us the
responsibility or the opportunity to tell them or tell the client or to kind of elaborate it for them, their thoughts of what should be the what should the brief be and what should their lifestyle be. And it sounds very pompous to be saying it this way, but that in the sense, because we deliberate on these aspects in detail, we have a clearer understanding of what is great living, what is great lifestyle. And when I'm saying great lifestyle, it doesn't mean essentially the way the world understands it. But yeah, we might be able to contribute in a more informed way. And having said that, it also is true that the clients or the people whom we are dealing in the outside architecture world are informed in many other ways in a much more sound manner with their travel or exposure. So one has to deal with that. Then one example which comes to my mind is in Sri Lanka, there's an architect called Jeffrey Bawa. And I don't know if you guys have seen his work. And I had gone and seen some of his hotels. Because they looked so beautiful. And it was the beauty which tempted me, the aesthetics which tempted me to go and see it. And what then I understood and learned from other people is also that when they were highlighting his projects, his hotel projects in a hospitality forum, and you know, they were lauding it as the new Asian style or the new tropical style and the way the hotels should be. And that's how the style should be. That's how every hotel should be. Then the architect who worked on those projects said, you know, you don't realize that they're frugal because they had to be frugal. But there were other means which made it frugal. It was because they were a war-stricken country. They didn't have resources. The buying capacity of those rooms was much lesser than what one would compare in India or other countries, even in the Southeast Asia. So, you know, these things of aesthetics come around from a need. And unless and until that need, and then it becomes a style. And if it's one was to just sell it as style, this is popular, please buy this today, they will change over. So we have the possibility as architects to influence lifestyle, which like Gaurav said earlier, you know, joint family systems, food systems, the way we reuse our products or we want to throw them away and get new ones. Now, these are things which it's soon... soon we will get into the habit of doing it, and the next generation will get into the habit of that is the new normal. But that need not be. If these values of reuse of furniture, or using a certain kind of material, or living with things that you make on your own, maintaining a garden, I mean, these are all parts of lifestyle which get reflected in interior. And you may make it interior design. And as architects, if we are going in as interior designers, trying to make a life for others, unless and until we get, we include their thoughts and make them think of what they need, it'll always be an external lifestyle forced on them. They'll soon change over to things that they believe is right. So I think somewhere you have to make them believe in things that you think are right and make them believe that it's right for them. That's my thoughts on it.
Yeah, I think the larger question is really not which interior finish has a larger footprint or which does not. I think the whole idea is to look at this whole idea of luxury and how it's kind of corrupting our senses and corrupting also the way that we look at design. And Rahul pointed out that design is luxury. I mean, and if you think about it as architects, if you have a list of things that you consider luxury, what are they? You know, and if you are pointing the same or checking the same boxes that your clients are, then chances are that you will not be able to convince them, right? So, I mean, if, for example, luxury is to you a bathroom with a heated seat, a toilet with a heated seat, then perhaps you would give it to your clients too. But for example, if luxury to you is finding the switch or the regulator of the fan exactly at this right distance from your bed so that you can lower the fan, you know, at night, if that is luxury to you, or you go to the middle of the night, you're going to the bathroom and you switch on the light and it doesn't blind you, and you're able to kind of do something to that light so that it doesn't blind you, if that is luxury, or finding your slippers, I'm talking like an old man now, finding your slippers just at the right place when you come back home, if that is luxury to you, I guess then, you know, there is a way of talking about luxury to your client, which is going to be convincing. But it just reminds me of a line Frank Lloyd Wright's autobiography, when he says that, you know, that he realizes that the right client that he's looking for, that same client is also looking for the same right architect, you know, and as hard or as you that rare client is looking for that rare architect. So we have to become those rare architects who will not give them what the others are giving them. And you will find those rare clients too in times to come. We just wait for them, that's all. And sometimes the patients or the bank balance to wait for such clients to come along. Well, that's the other part. But I guess if you can hold off and wait for those guys to come, they will.
I think there's a lot of aspiration from clients, and essentially that's what we're dealing with. We're dealing with a great amount of information and aspiration of clients, which is often threatening to us. And that is, and we kind of think that what they show us as Pinterest image is what they want. But we should just, I think, take it as that it's, they are trying to convey that they want something special, and they believe in our ability to create something special for them. Now, that special doesn't have to be a replica of what they show. But like, you know, there have been instances like somebody will come and say the Italian marble is the thing to be laid on the living room, and they settle for something Indian for the other spaces. But if you try and highlight that the beauty of the stone lies in its grains or in the way it's made, and it doesn't matter, and it's made in India, it is as beautiful as the others. And the fact that it's a natural material versus a man-made material, you know, you find a virtue getting an approval for the material or showing them the value in it. So that is where the I think we all need to work towards. But aspirations are not a wrong, bad thing. And not, you know, one will have to deal with it.
Got it. Any comments from the team?
You did bring up the aspect of COVID in thing with that Amit Goel quote, but has the COVID pandemic at all changed the way you looked at the topic?
Yes, sir. These days it is becoming like things are in 1990s or 2000s when lifts came into action, people thought that was also luxury. So maybe here, once we have seen a pandemic, things would change and people would want more space and more things, and that would be considered luxury as there is less space available in India. So we thought it would be right to consider.
Which is a shift that is in the real estate sector as well. A lot of developers are now going towards G+4 kind of structures in multi housing units, on the basis of that we allow more space between units and things like that, rather than.
Sir, during the COVID time, there were many good news that we got, like the pollution level drops significantly, the water bodies, the oxygen level of water bodies increased. So these all large news, we are the students, we understand the climate change and all that, but our elders, it's hard to convince them. But these kind of news made them also think like, yeah, this are less intervention brings good changes. So now it's not that difficult to convince them towards going for sustainable interior environments, because on a greater level now, they also know that, yes, this thing happens. Because if COVID won't have come, we couldn't have seen such kind of results anytime. So that's I think that it would have changed the perspective.
And I think it would work over here in this case, Ibrahim, to mention the fact that you are basing this on anecdotal evidence, that you've had that experience personally of dealing with clients and, you know, trying to convince them towards greener materials, and they've accepted. Though I don't know if the clients in Delhi would do the same thing. So Udaipur has a different, I think it still has heart, which might just be deeper and stronger and, you know, beat louder than yes, Delhi's sir. Approach to sustainability. I'm not saying Delhi doesn't have heart, it has heart in a different place.
So like we have so much of heritage buildings here, and like that has a good influence on us for going local.
So there's something I wanted to just add, guys, this is more for you. Thank you, Rahul and Sudipto. I think there's something that we missed out on. I think we adopted a slightly reductionist approach to quantification of luxury, because inside of what Rahul and Sudipto said, especially this whole aspect of architecture itself and design itself being a luxury, I think what would have been really interesting was if we would have explored more of how the design angle inside of what Rahul was sharing about Jeffrey Bauer's, based on need and necessity, design interventions being so rich as an output that the whole world still looks at it as an interpretation of tropical luxury of what it can look like. I think that could have been one angle that would have been a slightly more softer place to look at, but it would have been interesting to be able to try and quantify that in some way to see what would be the actual tangible impact on carbon emissions and reality, right? I think that's something that that I feel we missed out on in trying to only look at materials. But yeah, overall, I think it's all right, yeah. Any other comments from anyone else?
I think it's a very real time topic. You know, every office deals with it. It's a real time topic.
Every office deals with
where,
it.
You know, and you can extend it to internal air quality. I mean, what you discuss, because that is what is. I mean, our pandemic driven lifestyle is largely indoor, and our Delhi air quality also forces us to be indoor, which might be true for many cities. So this indoor space quality, you know, there are many aspects. There's so much research, and as architects, we think we are the form makers, but it's really the space inside that needs greater attention.
Absolutely. In fact, just speaking from experience, we were working as consultants for a residence in Defense Colony, 9,000 square feet, 180 kilowatts connected load. So we took it to the authorities, and the authorities said, no way, you have to show us this building. How are you even coming close to beyond 50? And we were like, dude, indoor air quality equipment, because they have HEPA filters, MERV 19, with 100% fresh air based system. And the authorities were shocked. So BACS actually said, no, they said, we are not giving you 180. So we had to go back to the drawing board and then convince the client for something completely different. The client could afford it in this case. So that was kind of like luxury meets reality in terms of energy infrastructure. And we had to go back to the drawing board, and fortunately BSES came to the rescue to, you know, thoda client ko ghode se utarne ke liye, so to speak. But I think as time goes by, plus with the pandemic, we'll see more such hard stops being put on us by authority, by governance, to say that, look, you need to control it some way or the other, and kind of, you know, tone it down. And I think architects are geared up for this. It's the clients that may not be ready. The clients may still want that Pinterest image, and it's up to us to be able to understand what's the demand behind the image and to address the demand behind the image and not the image itself. Yeah, absolutely.
Just as trees sequester carbon dioxide, luxury homes are meant to sequester liquidity and cash. You know, that's where they want to stick it. Because true. How do you use that money lying around, like crores and crores under your mattress? And sadly, this is the situation. This is, it's not the Pinterest image. It's like, what do I do with this, all this money?
Yeah. Luxury sequesters money. I guess you guys should use this as a quote on the cover of your report and then start your narrative. Super. Thank you.
All right. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
We finished on that exact to the minute.
Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable feedbacks.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
I'm sure with all the feedback and insightful conversations that we have had, we are all going to take back a lot today and we all have some food for thought. I want to take a moment to thank all the jurors, faculty, guides and students for being such an amazing audience today. This was our last presentation for the day, and I would like to now invite Tilak to give the closing remarks.
Thank you, Ayushi. I think with this, we come to an end of the seminar. So before we disperse, it feels incomplete to end the webinar without showing our appreciation to the jury members for all their inputs, to all the participants, and to all the participants for spending their valuable time patiently listening and viewing every presentation which came by. And a special thanks to people who actively participated. Further, on behalf of the students, we would like to thank our faculty members for constantly guiding us and being a source of inspiration through the last couple of months. We also would like to take this opportunity to thank all the volunteers and the support staff of various teams who put in their consistent effort and invaluable time in making this event a grand success. Finally, this event would not have been possible without the hard work, dedication, and teamwork that each and every student has shown throughout the duration of the semester. We disperse with hopes of gathering again. We wish you all a pleasant evening. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we are all looking forward to this same batch now producing designs. The next week is going to be the design week.
So thank you, Ayushi and Tilak, for coordinating it so well. Thank you, Gaurav. Why there is so much reason?
Everyone else, go on mute.
I think, Gaurav, these are two groups guided by you. That is the reason the attendance is around more than 100 students are still there. Otherwise, at the end of the session, generally we have a dwindling attendance. It happened yesterday, but now I noticed today that the attendance was increasing by the time your groups were coming for the presentation. So entirely due to your presence.
Got it. So I would say it's the enigma of the group itself and the jury members.
When we were deciding the guides initially and we were getting some kind of request that the preference for guides, so out of 19 groups, I think I had told you, Gaurav, this thing, 10 had given the option as Gaurav Shori. So that is the kind of...
That's brilliant, Gunjan. That means 10 were in the favor of sustainability. I really appreciate that. I'm but a symbol. Thank you. Thank you very much for keeping the flag flying.
Thank you.
And I don't know, I didn't hear that in Tilak's comment, but Professor Divan, Ranjana ma'am, Gunjan, you yourself, the faculty members who were actually backing the entire process despite the lockdown,
We had an inaugural session yesterday and all the thank you and everything we did during that time. So that's the reason that we don't have any of that session now.
I got that. So that's an acknowledgement from my side. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So we actually need to meet the jury for deciding the marks and other things. So so Deepta and Rahul, would you like to address them? Any common points which you would like to bring in front of the batch, like any across the groups which you must have seen the presentations?
Yeah, I think that, you know, I've been often commenting on the methodology, or I've been commenting on figures and diagrams, terminologies and so on. But finally, a good research is one that's done from the heart and goes to the heart of the matter. You know, that's something that you have to you have to be convinced about what you're doing first. I think once you are convinced about what you're doing, you will get your arguments correct. You will get your sequence right. It's only when you are struggling for a topic which has been handed down somehow, or which you kind of pulled from thin air, that's when you struggle with, you know, structure, when you struggle with methodology, with research questions and so on. So I would say that, you know, always keep wear your heart on your sleeve, look for things that affect you, look for things that move you. And if you are always connected to that, you will find research to be as easy as design, or design as easy as research.
Yeah, I think that I resonate the same parts, that it's really that connect with what we have been doing as students of architecture. You have been designing buildings, you've been studying buildings, built environment, and drawing them, you know. So that research, when you land up with a topic which is much wider in its scope, unless and until you bring it down to something that affects you, which some of the groups did, you have a focus. And through that lens, if you see the world, you will find it relevant, because as architects, we can contribute through our profession. Sometimes these topics are much wider because they are societal or they are environmental. But we'll have to boil it down to, it might be very reductive, but think of it as like an architect. What are you contributing back? And whether it's through windows, walls, plans, sections, you know, so it all comes down to what we are good at, and communicate it through that. So some of the papers, I thought, when we, it is alien to me because I am not a theorist, but I have my own practice, but I like to read and understand theories, but they have to relate to what we build and what we live in, at least in our part of the world. It's largely a very real-time experience. So if you can do that, if you can bridge that gap while you're addressing a topic through examples, through photographs, through, and bring it out. You know, these series are like Gunjan was saying, please don't shy away from showing what you see in the environment as photographs or videos or whatever. But they will inform you and they will kind of support your conclusions.
Research
is not only paper, you know. You can nowadays, I think, you are asked to write, but you can supplement it with photographs, videos, presentations.
I thought I saw Prasanna Desai just now.
Hi, Prasanna.
How are you?
Hi, I'm good.
Have you been here for a while?
Just last two presentations. Unfortunately, I couldn't, but a lot of my faculty members are there. Okay, and when I got the format, I was so excited. So I circulated this to the full faculty team and I told them that they must attend. And since yesterday, they have been attending and they've been putting the messages into the group. And I must compliment the entire team for a fantastic discourse you had for last week.
Thank you so much.
The memory lane, a nostalgia down the line, Ranjana. And good to see. I don't know. I know Sudipto not directly. But yes, I know Sudipto. And others I have not met. But I think the flag is on and the baton is there. And more so because SPA baton is on. So all for these young kids. I think one group had connected with me. Ranjana, you had directed them.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
And I spent number of hours with them on one evening.
Yeah.
So it is good to see, and I was always fascinated with, you know, those books which Molloy Chatterjee had printed years ago for this seminar. But I must share something different. I'm not going to comment on this. And these books which had these pastel colors, I used to pick up from the store, and I have a collection of them.
Yeah.
And I've been trying to tell my school and my faculty that we must come out with this book of inspiration virtually. So I remember the seminar which we had during Professor Narayana's time,
mm-hmm.
which Ranjana would remember, and the students may not really know who Professor Narayana, Professor Swami, and Professor K. Patel were. And it used to be only a structure seminar. And over a period of time, this has moved into this research.
Yeah, yeah.
So it is fantastic. And compliments to everyone, including Professor Diwan, Anil, and all the students. So we are connected because you belong to the same school. I belong to the same school. Ages ago, I passed out, 1980, very, very ancient time, 74 to 80, when Ranjana was also 3 years senior to me. So sorry to bringing in some nostalgia, but trying to tell you that it's wonderful to see younger generation. And I think this younger generation is going to change the world. You are the people who are going to do it. We have, yes, absolutely. There are no two opinions on this. And the middle generation is sitting there, Sudipto and his team. All the other jury members, Rahul, Sudipto, and we had someone else also, one of the most popular dissertation guides, looks like. 10 groups wanted him, and Gunjan is the coordinator. So wonderful to see this. Yeah, Gaurav.
Favorite.
So, Ranjana, you did write to me during Diwali. When are you coming to Delhi? I really don't know. I hope everything settles, and Delhi is always my first choice.
Good, good.
But I moved away from Delhi. So very good to see these young minds. And I must tell you that things will change. And what you are flagging and what the jurors said about, you know, changing the habits of clients. We need to, I can only say that we need to be a bit of activist also. You know, we have to bring in the activism, this joint family system, which somebody touched upon, one of the jury members, simple things of the clothes passing from elder brother to the middle, to the younger one, to the cousins. Today, I think people don't value it. They say, "Yaar, purana ho gaya, jara mall mein jaake naya nahi kharida." You know, so I think we have to change our lifestyle and things will change. And COVID has brought in this, I think, brought in a realization. And I'm sure people say the younger generation is like this and that. I feel the younger generation is simply brilliant, you know. And they are well exposed, very well exposed. And with the mentors like this who are there, I think we have a bright future. We have a bright future.
Well, that's...
So thank you, Ranjana, for spotting and giving me an opportunity to barge in. I'm sorry, Miss, I was not very sure whether I should barge in or not. But pleasure.
It has made our day, in fact. These words, the seminar, it has one wonderful end to this two-day program. Thank you so much.
My pleasure and honor. Yeah.
So can we go into the breakout room with the guys?
Yeah.
Yes, you have to give the marks. All the best to all.
Bye, bye. 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 Person.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Aman, are you setting the... Who is setting the Diljotpa?
Students, please do not leave the meet. Please stay here. Students, please do not leave the meet. Please stay.
I guess they're already leaving. We need to...
Yeah, drop a message in the batch group.
Yeah, I'll
And maybe you should stop recording, Diljot. I mean, sorry, and...
Okay.